both would like to come home to their home state and have a good ball game. Dardar to the 26-yard line, and let's take a look at the starting lineups on offense for Syracuse, brought to you by Russell Athletic. Marvin Graves. Many think he is as good as there is in the country, and you'll see why tonight out of Washington, D.C. Now, as wide receivers, one of the disappointments this year has been Shelby Hill. He's gotten off to a slow start. They need a big ball game out of him this evening. And on the offensive front, one thing that makes the coaches smile a bit, Kyle Adams, who's been out with a knee injury, their best offensive lineman, they get him back this evening. Number 79, he's a senior out of Webster, New York. From the shotgun on first down, zings it complete out of the backfield. It's Terry Richardson, and he will be gang tackled at the 31. So here are the starters for the Miami Hurricanes, the customary 4-3. The two bookends on the outside are so very good. Warren Sapp almost at full strength again. They'll get a big ball game out of him tonight. The linebackers are extremely young. In fact, Ray Lewis is only a freshman. But notice how many times we'll call number 52 tonight. And in the secondary, their best cover guy and the leader back there out of Avon Park, Florida, 34, Dexter Siegler. Said he fakes it to Wooten into the option play, turns it upfield, maybe one. That's it. Rohan Marley, one of the first men to come up and make the hit for the Miami Hurricanes. Also, Corwin Francis was the other one.
Ron, the 4-3 defense that Miami has made famous really is based on the fact that they have to get good play out of their defensive tackles and defensive ends. They're always trying to push the offensive line of scrimmage back.
Kenny Lopez, number 71. Third down, about a yard and a half. Just got it off. Option play to the short side, and with the pitch, they'll pick up the first down. Marcus Lee. And Mike, talk about how important that is to settle the crowd and also your offense rather than going three and out.
Well, it's a key first down. They ran the option into the short side of the field. Marvin Graves last week against Pittsburgh on the first play hit his knee and was hurt, and George DeLeon, the offensive coordinator, said he wasn't 100% this week. So I didn't know how many times that they would run the option, but the option is the play for Syracuse to keep the chains moving.
There you see the numbers on Graves for the season. 9 touchdowns, 4 interceptions. Rohan Marley, number 2. Picks up in the shotgun, but will not come with a blitz. Hit from behind, and the pass is overthrown. And with the pressure, Darren Krein, and Marvin had no time to waste on that play.
Good pressure by Darren Krein on Marvin Graves. But Marvin Graves, George DeLeon, the offensive coordinator, said he has to win the football game for us tonight. That's why they're starting out with him in the shotgun to try to ease up the pressure of the pass rush out of the front four.
Nice job of pass protection that time by the Syracuse offensive front. But it was the speed of Krein from the backside that gave them trouble. Second and 10. Richardson, hole on the left side, loses the ball, scrambled at the 39-yard line. And you can see that Lewis is upset because he thinks that Miami did not get the recovery, and they did not. It will stay with Syracuse.
Ron, this is what makes Miami tough to block. When they put those big defensive tackles in, and what they try to do with them is just roar up the field and cause confusion and not let you get to the linebackers. Now watch the linebacker, Ray Lewis, come through free, able to make the tackle, strip the ball, but it was recovered by Syracuse.
Ray Lewis is out of Lakeland, Florida. He is a freshman. And Mike, he has played like an upperclassman almost from the very first play they put him in.
Played strong safety in high school and returned kicks, so you know what kind of athlete he is.
They didn't get it off. Flags go down, and a 5-yard penalty will be stepped off. And there's so much noise in the Orange Bowl, the players could not hear it until the whistle was blown a second time. It's got to be a 3rd and 15 now.
Delay on the offense.
Paul Pasqualoni, who we're looking at, the head coach of Syracuse, said this front four may be the best entire front four that Miami's had. And when you talk about Jerome Brown, Cortez Kennedy, Russell Maryland, Rusty Medeiros, those type of players that have played for Miami, to say this is the best front four is a mouthful.
Clock back in 12 minutes and 20 seconds left to play in this opening quarter. Opening possession by the Cues. They picked up a first down, but now it's third and 15. Pressure up the middle. Graves hit as he throws. He's got a man open, overthrown, and Marvin Harrison had beaten Siegler on the near sideline.
Miami front four again. Watch the down four linemen. Darren Krein, number 91, will get by the block and get a hit on Marvin Graves, and that caused the ball to be overthrown.
May have cost them not only a big play, maybe 6 points, because he was 3 yards behind him. O'Neal to punt, and he'll kick it away to number three, Jonathan Harris, junior out of Houston, Texas. This is a booming high coverage kick. Harrison with the fair catch, and he'll make it at the 28. That is a 37-yard kick. Now let's take a look at the starters for the Miami Hurricane. Ryan Collins, you judge for yourself. He will get the call at quarterback tonight. The wide receiver is Christy Jones. He is as athletic and as good as any they've had here. And on the offensive front, this may surprise you a little bit, but the coaches think 63 Casey Jones, who is a redshirt freshman, may turn out to be as good a lineman as they've had here ever at Miami.
Important series to settle down the young quarterback Ryan Collins.
Donnell Bennett, no surprise here that they would come with the run, and he will have close to five. And let's check the starters for the Syracuse Orangemen. Kevin Mitchell, very tough, and in fact, opposing players say he's just downright mean. He is a very good football player. Here is the area of concern. Linebackers have been a problem all year, but Nate Hemsley brings a lot to the party. He's a big play man. And in the secondary, Tony Jones, two interceptions this year. Tony is playing with a cast on his hand, and we'll see how effective he can be tonight. Didn't get to play in the Ball State game. See the backers creeping up. Stewart is the lone setback. Here they come with a blitz. He stays in the block, and Collins' first pass is caught by Jonathan Harris.
Well, if you're Syracuse defensively, Kevin Coyle, the defensive coordinator, knows he's got a quarterback that played a little bit against Georgia Southern, hasn't been on the field a lot, so let's give him a lot of looks and try to confuse him. They blitzed him right off the bat. He was able to make the check off and throw the quick out to Jonathan Harris.
Here are the numbers on Collins for the season. As Mike said, he has played, but sparingly. 116 yards, two touchdowns, one interception. And gives it off to Derek Harris, big sophomore fullback out of Willow Ridge, Texas. And I don't know if he got the first down or not. He's very close. Syracuse says no. Kevin Mitchell is down at the bottom of that stack. And he will not pick up the first down as the kicking unit comes on.
Kevin Mitchell and Greg Shaw with good plays for the Syracuse defense.
Mike Crissy. We'll be back to kick. You see his average 39.9. He'll be kicking to number 12, the veteran, Shelby Hill. Light pressure, they got the return on. End over end with the kick. Hill. Breaks it. 35 and across the 40-yard line. Great field position for Syracuse. 41 yards on the kick and 14 on the return.
You know, there's one thing that most sporting events have in common.
Two on this streak of 53 wins in a row by Miami. Richardson and Luka. As he comes down the line with the pitch, and Richardson, big opening. He'll get blasted out of bounds at the 49, but it's a gain of 9 yards. Mike, yesterday, after the interviews in the practice, I walked with Marvin Graves over to the bus, and he said the one thing that makes Miami so difficult is, he said, they just don't have a weak link. you have 11 good athletes out there. And I said, can you get a good picture even in practice? And he said, no, because everybody runs so very well.
Well, that's the problem, but it's also a problem for Miami because the speed, the options coming at them right now, they couldn't practice on the other side.
Good point. Second and short. And they'll go straight ahead with Wooten. He will have the first down, and right now, it is the Syracuse Orangemen who are controlling the line of scrimmage very early on as we're about to hit 10 minutes to go in this one. But I have a feeling that the fellas from New York are thinking a little bit more confidently here than they did possibly when they came on the field.
Last year when Miami played Syracuse, Marvin Graves was on the field for 68 plays. Miami hit him on 38. So they're going to try to take a piece of him on every play.
Three wide receivers for Syracuse, and also Richardson comes in the slot for the right side. Looking pass. Marvin Harrison came off that one as Ray Lewis was about to come up and take his head off. Well, this is what the Syracuse records look like under Marvin. Total yards, passing yards, attempts, completions, and also completion percentage, over 60%.
Ron, tonight, Syracuse's most pressing problem, if they're to win this football game, their number one criteria on offense, pass protection. They're going to need to give Marvin Graves some time.
He's one of four so far tonight for 7 yards. Option for the other side. Pitches to Richardson, and that's Rohan Marley, who will knock him out of bounds at the 42-yard line. It's going to bring up a third down. And let's see, from where they've marked it, Syracuse is going to need about 5.5 yards.
Rohan Marley, number two. Watch the play that he makes. Now, here comes the option. Now, he's the only one out there on Marvin Graves, yet he's able to come off that play on Marvin Graves and make the tackle on Terry Richardson. He played them both on the option.
Rohan only 5'8", 205 pounds. But his teammates say you can hear him coming. They don't like to be in a part of the stack if the runner's not down.
No, he hums, and they know when he's humming, he's coming to hit somebody.
Line to make is the 36. Pressure from Krein. Gets away from him. Gets away from him again. Marvin Graves running for his life and just throws it away. And here comes a flag. Is this going to be grounding, or are they going to be called for roughing?
I think it's going to be grounding.
He threw that one into section 203.
Ron, that's the key for Syracuse tonight. Pass protection on Darren Krein. Warren Sapp also up the field. But here's what Marvin Graves will see. Little twist stun up inside Darren Krein. But see, Darren Krein never gives up. You see, he's had two shots at Marvin Graves. He's going to make sure the third one, he takes him down.
Boy, what an effort by Krein. Most defensive linemen don't have that kind of agility to get back and get a third shot at Marvin Graves.
That was the point the offensive coaches of Syracuse talked about Darren Krein and Kevin Patrick. They say they're relentless and they never stay blocked.
That also goes back to what I told you that Marvin said yesterday walking to the bus. He said everybody can run, even the big folks.
What an effort by Darren Krein on that play. Just would not give up.
So that is a loss of down. It is fourth down, Syracuse. And it actually, Miami gets a very big break here, Mike, in the fact they get an additional 15 yards rather than taking the ball over from the punt and poor field position. Or it should be that way.
Now the Syracuse defense will come on the field, Ron, and they had a pretty good series, that first series. And Kevin Coyle, their defensive coordinator, says we have to play well early to gain confidence. We have not stopped the run this year.
O'Neal, Mike has got a pretty good breeze in his face. It's another good coverage kick, though. Harrison calls for the fair catch at the 29-yard line. And Jonathan almost didn't get a hand up quickly enough. 35 yards on the kick.
I notice Miami doesn't have those kind of fans on their side of the field.
Collins in first down. Zings his pass. Has it complete to A.C. Tellison.
This is the series where Dennis Erickson now has made the call to the bullpen and said, now you're my quarterback. This is a series now that he has to turn him loose and show him that he has confidence in him to throw the football in the Miami offense. Nice throw here to A.C. Tellison on the curl. And you see the strength of his arm. He's got a very quick release. Where he's dangerous is when he gets on the corner, Ron, because the run pass threat
Yep, you have to dedicate a man to him, where Costa did not have that kind of speed. They fake the draw, he steps up, and this is just what Mike's talking about. Gonna run. Has five, has 10, counted off at 11. Chip Todd will shove him out of bounds. We asked Dennis Erickson yesterday about the reason for making the change at quarterback.
The decision was made not because of what Frank has done, because he really hasn't played all that bad. We're a little stagnant on offense right now, and I just felt that a change might make a difference offensively. I don't know. Ryan Collins is a little different than Frank, and runs around a little bit more, and we're just trying to make things happen, and that's exactly what I told Frank. And if things aren't happening, obviously we're going to put him back in the football games.
Well, they did not give him that extra yard. They said he stepped out of bounds just prior to it, so they go with the run, and Stewart breaks it big. Tries to cut it back. Pushed out of bounds. Let's see, they're going to say the 17-yard line.
All week, the Miami coaches have talked about James Stewart to me. They've said he's the biggest and the fastest running back we've ever had here in Miami and could leave here being the best. James Stewart, number 28, with a good block by number 40. Derek Harris in front of him. Now watch the big running back turn it loose. He's 10-5 in the 100 meters in high school. Tony Jones misses the tackle. 6'3", 235 pounds.
Mike, that's a heck of a job by Harris. He had been knocked down and still threw the block. 35 yards in the carry. You with one big guy, now they give it to another. Squares his shoulders, puts the head down, and he'll have a couple, and let's check in with Adrian Karsten.
Well, Ron, Frank Costa may not have started this game, but we're seeing the result of his experience and all of his starts here in the Orange Bowl. He pulled Ryan Collins over, Ron, on the bench with no one else around and said, look, be patient, take a deep breath, look beyond your primary receiver, don't let the crowd bother you.
Ron, you know he's going through a tough time, and you talk about teammates, you talk about role players. Frank Costa, as we said before, didn't play bad in the five games. They were just looking for a spark, and Rich Olson says we need touchdowns, not field goals, and that's now the problem, that they're in the area inside the 20 now to get a touchdown and not a field goal.
Right. Second down and nine, drills the pass, has it complete, Harris, and inside the five.
See, I'm impressed with that move by Ryan Collins, because everybody talks about his running ability. He didn't want to take off here. Out of the shotgun, watch Ryan Collins. Now, he has a chance to take off and run the football, but he's patient, waited for his receiver number three, Jonathan Harris, to come open, hit him with the football. Now they're in business on the three.
Bennett and Harris are the setbacks. It is first and goal. And it's Bennett. Hammers the left side, and at the 1 yard line will be shoved back. It's Bevel up from the secondary to make the initial hit.
Well, on the first drive, Dennis Erickson, as we talked about, he wants touchdowns, not field goals. He felt that that's what was wrong with his offense. They couldn't make the big play to get in the end zone. They'd be forced to kick the field goal. And now you see the big back, James Stewart, reporting into the huddle.
Wide side of the field is to the right. Let's see if they go with a pitch to him, if they just send him off tackle. He can do either. Pitch, touchdown, there is a flag down, and let's see what the marker is about.
Offside on the defense, the flag.
Stewart gets the touchdown, and by the way, Mike, the key play on this drive was a 35-yard run by Stewart on third and short, and that was his longest in his career.
Well, that, he'll race that quick, because he's going to have a lot of runs longer than 35 yards.
Dane Pruitt knocks it home, and with 6:41 left in this opening quarter, as you take one more look at Stewart on the touchdown, it is the Canes, 7-0. Goal line. It's a head down. Wow, he sends a Hurricane flying back at the 25-yard line. That's a good, tough return. Kenny Holmes, number 90, freshman out of Arrow Beach. Actually, got the start at defensive end tonight. Is the one who got belted back.
Syracuse has had a little success with the option, so they may want to come out here on first down, try to establish something running the football against Miami.
Lee and Dardar, the setbacks this time. Graves sets it over the middle, has a complete Shelby Hill, and he takes a couple of good pops just as he makes the reception. C.J. Richardson, the first man there.
Ron Rohan Marley, the linebacker, of course, he's the son of Bob Marley, who passed away with a great reggae singer. And last week when the open date, most of the Miami players went to the beach. He went to Jamaica, and Tom Tuberville, linebacker coach, I'm a little worried about you. You're going to eat all right? He says, yeah, my chef will take care of that. And he said, how about, are you going to work out? He said, my masseuse will take care of that. So he doesn't have any worries.
Should have invited some teammates.
Well, Tommy Tuberville says, can I go with you? And he said, no, that'll be an NCAA problem.
That's right.
They fake the hit and the sack. It was going to be an option pass, and as you could see, Patrick and Cryan just made a sandwich out of it.
Well, Miami takes the option pass away because Marvin Graves tries to throw the pass on the line of scrimmage, but with the tackles and the defensive ends, Darren Cryan, Kevin Patrick, Warren Sapp, see number 91, Darren Cryan, he does not allow you to throw the ball off of the line of scrimmage.
Mike, Dardar may also have known that it was going to be a pass play, but if there was any option left, he didn't help him because he didn't string it out. He was too close to his quarterback, no place to pitch. Third down, and the line they need to make is out at the 36-yard line. Overthrown, and again, Marvin Graves winds up upside down. Riley hit him. Let's check in with Adrian Karsten.
Ron, there's Darren Cryan in the backfield one more time. I talked to him right before kickoff. What he told me he was going to do is widen his stance further outside the offensive tackle instead of coming right up the field and outside that tackle, taking one step forward and then dashing inside. We're seeing how well that's working.
Well, on third down, when you catch Syracuse and you put them into a passing situation, watch both Darren Cryan. Adrian's right. They'll widen their stance and they'll just put their ears back on a pass rush. But the important thing on that play, Pat Riley hit Marvin Graves again. They're just going to continue to pound him.
Well, this thing takes a huge Miami bounce. They'll get the ball at the 48-yard line. Well, next Saturday, here on ESPN, it's a very big day for the little guy. First of all, in the Big Ten, take a look at that. Number 13 against number 13. They're tied going into today's action at 12:30. Michigan against Wisconsin. CFA primetime. It is West Virginia against Syracuse. 17 against number 22. And then third game of the triple header. This is where Mike, Adrian, and myself will be on the West Coast. Arizona at UCLA all next Saturday.
I think Arizona's one, and UCLA's, I believe, up 7-3 in the second quarter.
Yep, 7-3 over Oregon State, actually at halftime. Thomas with the play action, rolls the pocket, drills it too high.
Ron, the interesting thing about Ryan Collins is, and you and I talked about this before the game, but you're in the sixth week of the season. All the preseason practice, Frank Costa got all the work. And you can only work one quarterback. Your second quarterback's going to get very little work. But Dennis Erickson had enough confidence in Ryan Collins to say at the middle of the year against a good opponent in Syracuse, you're my quarterback. He went to the bullpen, found his replacement, and again, Frank Costa still can get on this field and play. He's not out of this thing either.
The other luxury that that Dennis had is the fact he had a week off, so he had 2 weeks to work in as far as reps and practice. James Stewart on the draw play. Big opening again. Look at bodies flying. Still running over people inside the 20-yard line. Hensley finally makes the stop.
Well, we talked about his longest run being 35 yards a minute ago. Of course, there's a flag on the field, but James Stewart really is showing something.
I have illegal push in the back by the defense.
Illegal push in the back against the defense.
Block of Terrell Green, number 51, is going to be the key block. Now watch as the big back, 235 pounds, just ran through a tackle of Bryce Bevel, number 3.
In penalty against the Orange Man.
There's only one senior starter on this offense, so if you're scheduling Miami in the future, you got some real problems. This is a young football team and a young offense.
Get off as quickly as possible, huh?
Get them off the schedule and call your athletic director at home tonight.
Well, that's two runs now. That's a 33-yard run. So in two runs in this quarter, 68 yards between the two. Ball just inside the 10. First and goal. The 1-2 punch. This is Donnell Bennett at the 5. You can hear the groan of the crowd as Bevel came up and hit him. But I take both of these backs, Bennett is 227, Stewart is 235, and both like to put their head and shoulders down and just, you know, go headgear to headgear with you.
Two strong backs. They're just going to try to wear you down. On the other side, Syracuse has had problems with the run, even problems that they've tried to move their great middle guard, Kevin Mitchell, back to linebacker to help at the linebacker position. But they found that that didn't help him, moved him back to the nose guard position. Miami will make sure he's doubled most of the night.
Tevison is a wide receiver, bottom of the screen, but it's a running play. Stewart driving folks into the end zone for the touchdown.
Key block run by Casey Jones, the center, who you talked about early in the ballgame, 6'1", 255-pound freshman. Dennis Erickson say may be the best lineman they've had. He's working against Kevin Mitchell, number 50. And you see a one-on-one block where he just ties up Kevin Mitchell. And then Stewart is so big and quick, just ran right past him. Another look. The linebackers play catch. That's the strong safety, Bob Grosvenor, number 27, making the final tackle in the end zone.
Dane Pruitt, 14-0 Miami Hurricane, with 3:55 left in this opening quarter. They're here for the ball game.
And Ron, they're not out of the national hunt yet. They're still alive.
Richardson and Dardar back deep, but it's Dardar at the 7. Going to be tackled at the 25, and for the first time this evening, let's check in with Mike Tirico. Mike.
Good evening, Ron. Minnesota at home up 14-0 on Wisconsin in the second quarter, and Darryl Bevel is picked off by Jeff Roska. One man to beat, it's Bevel, and he beats him, and Minnesota leads Wisconsin by 21 in the second.
Wow, the Golden Gophers. Do you think that maybe Jim Wacker is on his tiptoes on the sideline?
Well, he's
unbelievable.
He might be on his tiptoes, but John Cooper's probably on his too, watching it.
Well, from Arden Graves, to show you what the pressure has done to him, he's only hit one of his last six passes. He's 2 of 7, 16 yards here in this first quarter. Option play, pitches to Richardson. Tries to get a block, and he's going to be hit with an open field tackle. Let's check in once again with Adrian Karsten and a special guest. Adrian?
Ron, very special man who played a few downs here in the Orange Bowl, Michael Irvin. Michael, after last week's effort, I think you deserve a weekend off, huh?
Yeah, well, the team played great last week, and this is not a weekend off. I'm here working hard, making sure these guys come through with a win today.
With what we're seeing, two touchdowns right out of the gate here, are these guys playing better because alums like you are here on the sidelines tonight?
Well, and you know what? I think when you play for the University of Miami, you always have that tie-in. I mean, they know anytime we get a chance to make a game, we're going to make the game.
This really is more of a football fraternity instead of a team. I mean, you guys, the Cortez Kennedy rents a jet, wants to fly all the Cowboys back here. I mean, half the team is here, for crying out loud. This really is a fraternity, isn't it, Michael?
But that's just the way we do it. You know, that's the way we play the game. We're a tight team. You know, it carries over in our off-season work habits, work ethics and everything. We go out, we work together. When I come home in off-season, I go and train with the guys, try to teach them a little things that I know from the NFL they can use on the college level.
Pretty neat press in a national sports magazine this past week. 15 of 17 kids. I mean, I'm hearing stories about how much you eat. What's all that?
I don't know. You know what I mean? I thought, hey, you know what? We did that thing a long time ago. I thought we were going to talk more about football. You know, I'm a blessed man. I'm a lucky man. I got great parents, and they done a great job.
Hopefully not the Jinx cover of Sports Illustrated.
No, that's why I'm glad we had the week off. We won't have the Jinx. We won't have to worry about it.
Great to see you, Michael. Thanks very much.
Thanks.
Thanks, Adrian. Nice job. You loaned him the necklace, did you? Pressure coming up the middle. Graves' pass is caught. Was Hill in bounds? Yes. You can see Warren Sapp getting up off of Marvin Graves, which has been the scenario of this ball game all evening.
You know, it's interesting that Syracuse, the Miami defensive coaches told me that this year they've had 600 snaps of the football, and they've only been blitzed 15 times. And the reason for that, Ron, is because they run the option, and you don't want to be in man coverage because your players get run off. And so, but Miami feels they have enough speed that they can blitz Syracuse. That time, Syracuse picked it up.
In fact, one of the things, Mike, that Syracuse, or Miami, has prided itself on is not having to send backers or corners. To the short side. Marvin Graves hit by Krein, and Krein came from the backside to show you the kind of mobility he has.
Freeze option play by Syracuse. Syracuse can have made this famous. Tailback just sits in the backfield on the start of the play. He doesn't show any movement right away because they do not want to give the linebackers a key which way the ball's going. But Darren Krein was on a move inside and was able to catch Marvin Graves from behind.
Well, Rohan Marley is coming off the field. He was shaken up. And, Mike, if he is not on the field for the snap, which he's not going to be, this will be the first play that has missed the entire season on defense.
And as you watch him, the Syracuse coaches said every game you watch, we see a play that he makes. It's so spectacular. We turn the projector off, turn it back on numerous times for our players to see. Just see, he just fell down, may have twisted his ankle.
Got kicked in the shin.
Kicked in the shin. James Burgess, number 54, will replace him.
And he's another freshman. Linebackers show blitz, they stay at home. Running play will go for a couple, but Al Wooten has no place to go.
Robert Bass, number 49, made the tackle run, came in at middle linebacker. He was a starting middle linebacker and got hurt. Now he's back in there for Miami.
So you take out a freshman who has been extremely productive, you put a senior back in, and just the beat goes on.
Well, the frustrating thing for Syracuse is there's a hole, but it's only there for a fraction of a second because there's so much speed on the Miami defense.
Third down, and they need the 50. It up, gonna run it. Oh my goodness, does he get tagged? Bass, one of the first men, and Darren Krein also, along with Baraka Short.
Well, they want to make sure, we talked about it early, they want to make sure they tag him on every play that they can hit him. They have so much respect for Marvin Graves as a quarterback, they want to wear him down as the game goes along. Robert Bass, number 49, amongst others, makes the hit.
I tell you, Marvin is a tough, tough kid, but I'm not sure how many hits like that he can take, Mike. That wasn't just one, that was two and then three.
The other thing to think about a little bit, when northern teams come down to Miami, Miami sells their players on the humidity, will eventually get the northern team in the second half.
O'Neill's kick, end over end this time to Jonathan Harris. No fair catch, he'll try for the return, and good job by Syracuse. Well, the weekend kickoff show, Thursday evening, 7:40 Eastern time, 4:40 out in the Pacific. And we'll start your college football weekend off with required viewing. Then following the kickoff show is Rutgers at Pittsburgh. Craig James and I will be in the Meadowlands with Dr. Punch.
I'm going to head out early for the Arizona-UCLA game. Going to watch Arizona practice this week on Wednesday, and then I'll meet you in Los Angeles.
Los Angeles. That game, of course, will be at the Rose Bowl. Play action by Conley. Look at the pressure at the middle. Gets away from it. Going to run. And falls down at the 27, and let's get an injury update from Adrian on Marley.
Yeah, Rohan Marley, Ron, is trying to rework in his right knee that was twisted on that last defensive series. He says that team doctors tell me he's ready to go.
Ron, the last play is why Ryan Collins is the quarterback. He took a bad play and made it into a good play.
Made it into 8 yards. You're right. That's the end of the first 15 minutes. Miami 14. 14 to nothing. Miami leads as we head to the second quarter. And this is what Dennis Erickson was talking about with his change at quarterback, I think, Mike.
Well, Ryan Collins will show you here why he's now the quarterback. Bad play because Kevin Mitchell puts pressure on. Now he decides to run the football, and instead of being sacked and losing 5 yards, he gains 8+.
So here are his numbers in that first 15 minutes of play. James Stewart, and he is stopped at the line of scrimmage, maybe short of the first down. 34 yards passing, 17 rushing in that opening 15 minutes.
Ron, Kevin Mitchell, defensive nose guard for Syracuse, made that last play, and Rich Olson, the offensive coordinator, said he's the best defensive lineman we've seen who plays for four quarters. He just plays the entire game. Strong, quick, plays with great determination. Number 50.
Mike, I can remember we did a game, you were not with us at the time, but we did the game up at Syracuse against Michigan State. When he was a freshman, Conley was a freshman who they lost because of the knee injury, but those guys were absolutely everywhere, 49 and 50.
Dan Conley injury to Syracuse really hurt him because he was the linebacker that set everything up for Syracuse. He got everybody lined up, and when they lost him, the loss was so great for Paul Pasqualoni that he tried even to put Kevin Mitchell back last week against Pittsburgh at linebacker, but he's back at the nose position.
Well, they did measure, and Miami did pick up the first down. Conley swings it out. This is Bennett. And Bennett will take it forward to around the 34-yard line. Mitchell, along with Chip Todd defensively.
They have so much respect for Kevin Mitchell that they have to double-team him. You see Terrell Green, number 51, blocking, number 63, Casey Jones working on him also, Rudy Barber. If you usually will put two offensive linemen on Kevin Mitchell, and if you can only put one, then you'll use your running back to chip off on him a little bit.
Look at this. Started all 43 games of a Syracuse career.
He is an outstanding player.
Now they pull the tackle. Stewart, and he gets tagged very hard, but he has the first down. It's going to be Mitchell who gets a piece of it, also Grosvenor.
Well, the player that made this play, Zeb Lemelski, number 77, the big lineman, because he is the pulling tackle that sets up the block for James Stewart.
Mike, I think one of the biggest surprises to me this year is the way this offensive line has played, because it was almost a trouble spot at times last year for Miami. And this is certainly the biggest offensive line they've ever had.
Well, it's a big line, and as we talked about, one senior on that offensive line.
Conley over the middle, Jones, and Larry Jones breaks the tackle and will have the first down. Now, folks, here's what you run into when there's not enough footballs to go around and you got this many great players. Larry Jones comes in the game. He is a starter when they go with a two-back set. They get him the ball, fresh legs. He breaks tackles and picks up a first down.
So much talent on this field, and I said earlier, we're going to have John Junker from the Fiesta Bowl on here after the half, and he'll talk a little bit about Miami's, what they have to do to get another crack here to win the national title.
Headgear goes flying, and Bennett will take it down to the 41-yard line. And is it Terrell Green, who had his headgear thrown off?
Well, he's 6'3", 300 pounds. He might be able to play without one. He's so big.
Here are the sizes. We normally don't put up weights during the starting lineups, but the two tackles, Perry on the left side is 6'7", 310. Lemelski on the right side is 6'7", 300. The guards, Barber is 6'3", 295. Green is 6'3", 300. And Casey Jones at center, 6'1", 255, is the really stealth one. Pitch coming to Stewart. He He's only a sophomore, and I think by the time he leaves here, he might have a record or two in his hip pocket.
See a lot of missed tackles by Syracuse. Greg Shaw overran this play. Number 48, Chip Todd, number 57. Watch the pitch to James Stewart, but watch the missed tackles. 57, Chip Todd misses him. They're just running through the tackles of Syracuse. And a lot has to do with the strength of James Stewart, but a lot has to do with it looks to me like Syracuse tired a little bit on defense.
Now, Mitchell being worked on. You can see that they are putting on a sock, a new one on that right foot. Obviously, they retaped it. We'll try to get a report. Larry Jones to the outside, turns the corner, then runs into the corner, Dwayne Joseph, as he tried to put a hold on him. First and 10, Miami, and now they're picking it up in all just chunks of a dozen yards at a time.
Ron, here's a move by Miami now. What they are able to do is they're going to two tight ends now. And with the two tight ends, watch the left tight end with a seal block. They're trying to balance up this defense and trying to run at Nate Helmsley, number 41, because he's 6 foot, 206 pounds. So if his program weight's 206, that means he's about 195.
Now this is Bennett to the left side. They seal off the corner. They're still on his feet at the 5-yard line, and this is reminiscent of what he did against the Colorado Buffaloes. When they hit him at the 35, he broke through two tacklers and went the distance for the touchdown.
Same strategy, Ron. Two tight ends to force Syracuse to balance up. Show you again, tight ends on both sides, and now that's putting this linebacker right here in a little bit of a bind. Number 41, Nate Helmsley. 206 pounds taking on the big backs of Miami and that big offensive line.
Chip Todd had to save it, and if Chip had given up on his effort, Bennett would have been in the end zone.
Good move by Miami, Dennis Erickson, to go to the two tight end offense.
10th play of the drive. Straight up the middle. Touchdown, Derek Harrison. The kick by Pruitt is good. Check the marker.
Offside on the defense.
Yeah, one thing, Ron, Miami's people that shoot that cannon, they don't wait for the referees. They have a lot of confidence. Their team doesn't make many mistakes. They fire.
Let's take a break. The 14 win was highlighted by Michael Irwin's touchdown catch. 1987 Orange Bowl. Good look at Michael down on the sideline tonight. Boy, Mike, speaking of stunners, as you look at all across the way, giving a stern lecture to his football team. Oregon State 10, UCLA 7, midway of the third quarter.
Well, I'm sure UCLA may be caught looking ahead a little bit. You figure they're going to be good enough to come back and win their game.
Gardner is going to take it from a yard deep.
Now, here's the strategy that Miami's using with the two tight ends. They're trying to attack the linebackers. Nate Helmsley, who's 206, and Greg Shaw, who's 218 and a freshman. So they're making the Syracuse defense balance up and then just pounding them. And you see number 40, Derek Harris, just run through the tackle of Greg Shaw.
Well, everybody has gotten into the act tonight.
Good strategy.
On the sideline, one of the defensive players being talked to the coaching staff across the way. Yeah, the Syracuse coaches know has gotten very serious quickly. 21-0, and we still have 11:02 left to play until the halftime. Takes it to Gardar. Pressure is there. Patrick has a hold. It is caught in midair, and touchdown, Kenny Holmes. interception. It was caused by Kevin Patrick, and Kenny Holmes, his teammate, Mike, was right there, the glad and happy recipient. 11 yards.
Miami made a defensive switch against Syracuse, but Syracuse went to the two tight ends. Miami changed up with a five-man front. It may give them a little bit of a problem. That was the key for Syracuse, to give Marvin Graves protection. Failed on that play.
Dane Pruitt is good, and we'll take a break. 10:55 left until halftime. 28-0.
Going down and in the flat, but Miami is so quick, Ron.
This is going to be Richardson.
Now Syracuse just needs to regain your composure. You have a senior quarterback in Marvin Graves. Just got to go back to what you do best.
Kevin Patrick, who caused the play just a moment ago with the pressure on Marvin Graves and causing him to throw the interception, that's what they have ruled it officially. And 11 yards on the return by Holmes. Wooten, he'll have one, and let's check in with Adrian Karsten. Adrian.
Ron and coach, something from the offensive side, actually defensive sideline for Miami here. They're not going to slow down. Watch for this now. One back set by Syracuse. They're going to load up and really blitz the hell out of them.
Pretty emphatic. I'd say they're going to blitz them then.
Well, one of the war cry this week in practice, as you look at Coach Trevorville on the sideline, is they're not happy about losing to Florida State. They want to prove to the world that they are very good. Graves, looking pass, complete to Harrison. And let's check in once again with Mike Tirico. Mike?
Ron, you gave the score with Oregon State up. Let's show you how it happened. Out of the bone, John Young, the one-yard run. Oregon State leading 10-7 in the third. UCLA has the ball, though, at the Oregon State 10.
Okay, so the Yukon's trying to come back. That's easy to happen when you're looking ahead. And, of course, next week, that's their ball game. They have Arizona coming in town.
Still think Syracuse has to, even though they're down 28-0, has to establish something on the ground. Here they're going with an unbalanced line to the right.
To Richardson. This one he turns up and will have 7, maybe 8 yards in the play. First and 10 Syracuse, and they needed that one desperately.
Good play call by George DeLeon, the offensive coordinator, to try to settle Miami down a little bit. Establish the run. Now see what they only have two linemen over here. They've got two receivers. They got three linemen here and two receivers out. So they're unbalanced to the right. Miami doesn't make an adjustment to the unbalance. So now Syracuse has an extra man to block for number 44, Terry Richardson. Good call by the Syracuse coaches.
Graves comes out from under center, calls a timeout. So we'll take it with him. 8:46 until it happens to them as well. Reverse option, and Kevin Patrick is right there to destroy it all.
Front four of Miami is just dominating this football game, and this is George DeLeon, the offensive coordinator, who has a giant size headache right now. He told me the other day, he said, if we get one dimensional in this ball game, they're just going to grind us up. So he's trying to get a mix in his offense. Look at the front four from Miami. Just control. Here comes the reverse around, but again, a great call by Tom Tuberville, the defensive coordinator. Kevin Patrick's up inside to make the tackle.
Even the reverse man's player against him had beaten the situation, but Patrick got him anyway. Graves will dump it off to Richardson. And Richardson going to be hit in the open field, and Corwin Francis, then along with help from Kenny Holmes, and they got got Syracuse going the wrong direction. And let's check in once again with Mike Tirico. Mike, what do you have for us?
All right, Ron, back to the UCLA-Oregon State game. UCLA moving down, and where else is Wayne Cook going to go? J.J. Stokes, one more time in the end zone. That's 11 times in the last four games. Bruins back on top by four.
Boy, Stokes has just been a thorn in everybody's side this year.
Had a chance to watch him against San Diego State. He really uses his body well, has great speed, and the 6'4", 6'5", height. And he's just an unbelievable receiver.
Good kid, too, isn't he, Mike?
Outstanding.
Third down, and they need to take it all the way across midfield to the 48. Look at the pressure on Marvin. Running for his life. He gets one pickup block. Still out, gets another. Now drills it, and has it complete to Harrison. And Harrison down to the 36-yard line. And give credit not only to Marvin Graves, but that offensive line came back and protected their man.
Well, they missed him on the first block, but they were able to come back and get him on the second. But Warren Sapp, when you watch, Marvin Graves does a great job here. You see the stunt, but now look at number 76 chasing him. He's 6'3", 300 pounds. He gets picked off by Cy Ellsworth, number 64. But again, now credit Marvin Harrison because he never gave up on the route. Keeps moving, even though Marvin Graves is in trouble, and is able to come back and make the reception. Number 8, Marvin Harrison.
That play is good for 30 yards. Dardar to the right side, breaks through a tackle, and takes it inside the 30 and down to the 27. That is the toughest run by a Syracuse back tonight.
Well, you're right, Ron, and I give credit to George DeLeon. I'm going back to him because you could panic when you're behind 28-0 against Miami and start pitching the ball all over the place. But what he's trying to do with his offense, and Paul Pasqualoni on the sideline, is just keep him in the football game, keep running the football, get a little bit of mix, and slowly try to get back in this thing.
Well, there's the average on rushing yardage tonight. 15 attempts, 3 yards. And you can see just that short. .603 left until halftime, 28-0 Miami. Certainly the most impressive drive of the evening for Syracuse. Wishbone set again. Look how tight Miami brings it in. Dardar to the right side, hit at the line of scrimmage, fights his way for the first down at the 24. And Darren Krein is the fellow who wrapped him up.
The Syracuse coaches last night showed the film of the last year's Arizona game when Arizona missed the last field goal that would have beaten Miami here, and they talked to their team about a team that was focused, and then Arizona went on, and since that game is 13-1, so tried to give them a little bit of motivation to come in here and play against Miami.
Arizona did well after that. I think George was wrong in his number. I think they lost 3, but still, they did turn their football team around. Well, I'm afraid there's going to be a delay of game. It is against Syracuse.
On the offense.
Let's go down and check in with Adrian Karsten.
Ron, some injuries to key players for both sides. First, Rohan Marley. You don't see him in the game because he's still nursing that right twisted knee back from the first quarter. He's about 75%, I am told by their staff. They don't want to play him unless they absolutely have to. Now, Kevin Mitchell, remember back Miami's last offensive touchdown when they went at that inside linebacker. Mitchell was not in the game because he had twisted his right ankle. Couldn't get him back in the game fast enough because he had a knot in his shoestring.
But at least that's fixable. Ninth play of the drive. Richardson. He'll take it inside the 25. Ron Franklin, Mike Gottfried, and Adrian Karsten, glad to have you along tonight for the Orange Bowl in Miami, Florida, with the Hurricanes trying to bounce back ahead of a week off They lost to Florida State 2 weeks ago, and tonight they are out and running 28-0 over Syracuse, also an opponent from the Big East.
Syracuse just continues to run the football. Good strategy by Paul Pascal and George DeLeon. Look for him to keep running the football.
Option play pitch to Richardson. Tries to put a move on, is forced back inside, and that's a great job by Francis. And Mike Tirico, what do you have for us?
It's back to the pack. Oregon State, Ron, is without their best quarterback, Don Shanklin. So Raheem Mohammed, the freshman, is in there on the option pitch. Cameron Reynolds, 43 yards. Oregon State back up by 3.
Well, I have a feeling that the words on the sideline from Terry Donahue to his football team will be rather severe. I need to explain to you that here in Miami, the guy who runs the sound down here works for a hearing aid company on the side, I feel sure. And sometimes it's rather hard to hear.
Well, he'll sell two tomorrow right here in the booth.
Graves is going to be hit and sacked back at the 35-yard line. Pat Riley.
They just, from the snap of the football, they just collapsed the pocket with the front four. Kenny Lopez, Warren Sapp, Kevin Patrick, Darren Krein, you see, trying to get the crowd into it. And then that allows the linebackers just to come free.
Yeah, you can see a very frustrated Marvin Graves as he heads off the field. That was far and away the best drive by Syracuse this evening. But just what Mike was talking about. A goodly part of it, even in a wishbone set with two tight ends so they could run the football. And it, when it came time to throw, Miami thwarts it. Riley with the big sack. O'Neill's attempt will come from 52 yards away. Flag is down.
Dead ball. False start on the offense.
Now, Mike, do you let him try it again? Here comes some replacements in. I know that Pat O'Neill is also the punter. And it looks that's what's going to happen. The legal procedure is going to force him out of the field goal.
I won't answer your question now. I'll just let Paul Pasqualoni answer.
Very high kick. Miami doesn't have anybody back. Good job by Syracuse, and they'll down it at the 5-yard line. 36 yards and a kick, and it was Malcolm Thomas who got down underneath it. Now here's a comparison of the two quarterbacks so far tonight.
Ryan Collins having a great night, 5 out of 6, 53 yards. Not a lot of throwing attempts because they're controlling the ball on the ground. Marvin Graves with not very good protection, 6 out of 13, 59 yards, 1 interception. Ron, Syracuse has 2 timeouts left, so now they have to think a little bit about using their timeouts if they can stop Miami on 1st and 2nd down.
Miami actually has brought on 2 tight ends, Mike, down deep in their own territory.
That's their strategy now, trying to balance up, trying to get after number 41, Nate Helmsley, the linebacker.
Donnell Bennett tries to turn the corner. If he does, puts a head down. Still running and forced out of bounds after a gain. And that's going to be 15, 16, 17 yards. Wow. Perry with a very good block, and you can see that Bennett is down in the vicinity of that fan as he continued to drive defensive players with him off the field.
Ron, the key again is a 2 tight end offense. Watch number 73. There's number 41, Nate Helmsley, 200-pound linebacker. Now, number 73, Ricky Perry, 6'7", 310 pounds. And that's the strategy. They're just going to try to run at Nate Helmsley.
Now, Joseph was the last man over there, but there was nothing malicious as far as Syracuse was concerned. He just had a lot of momentum wound up banging the fan, but I think he's going to be all right. Yeah, that's good. Adrian Karsten, let's go down to you.
Around the list of alums continues to grow here. Jesse Armstead, drafted by the Giants, playing behind a guy named Lawrence Taylor, somebody like that. Defense doing a heck of a job tonight.
Yeah, they're doing a great job. And offense coming through, we're looking much better now.
What is it about playing in the Orange Bowl? 53, potentially 54 straight games here, Jesse.
Well, you know, nobody can come in the Orange Bowl and beat us. It's a legacy around here, and all the old players come back, and when you come in the Orange Bowl, you know you got a loss.
It shows. Jesse, appreciate the time.
All right, bud.
Ron?
Okay, thanks, Adrian. They do believe in coming back and spurning this team on. It's Jonathan Harris on the receiving end. He'll stop the clock to 18.
There is no doubt in my mind coming in here, and there's no doubt in my mind now, this is the best football team in the Big East. And as we talked last week, probably one of the five best football teams in the country.
It's one of the reasons when we did our own top 10 ranking last week, and I said, you know, I still think you got to put them with one loss ahead of several teams on there that don't have a loss. This is, and what's so scary is what you said in the first quarter. We got so many young players. Good hit in the backfield, and going to be knocked for a loss. Greg Shaw came through, and James Stewart that time.
And if the folks will stay with us, we're going to have John Junker on after the half, and he will explain the scenarios that Miami needs to still be in the national hunt.
You think that could happen, Mike?
The executive director of the Fiesta Bowl, yes. And if it does happen, it'll be in the Fiesta Bowl. That's why he's going to come in and explain it.
Thanks. No one explained it to me that way.
28-0 our score as the clock runs at 1:40 left until halftime. And runs for his life this time. He's beyond the line of scrimmage, isn't he? Yep. Throws it in and out of the hands of Chris T. Jones. Now let's see, did he go beyond the... Yep, here comes the flag. He was beyond the line of scrimmage.
An illegal pass by the offense.
The penalty against Miami for an illegal forward pass.
It's the first mistake that Ryan Collins has made tonight. Just a little indecision. Remember, he hasn't had a lot of practice time except this week when he worked with the number ones all the time.
Well, now those two timeouts may come into play that you talk about that Syracuse has left up there as Chrissy will come on to punt.
By the offense, 5 yards from the spot of the pass, loss of down.
This is only the second punt for the Hurricanes in this first half.
I know it takes a lot of the secret away when you're throwing the football, but Syracuse would be wise to go in the shotgun to try to give Marvin Graves a little bit more time against that front four to throw the football. Having some success with the option, I'd stay with that.
Coming up the middle, Chrissy gets it away. And Shelby Hill at the 50 has the return to the right. And the speed of Miami and the special teams is demonstrated right there. Good heavens. C.J. Richardson just outran anybody who wanted to block him. Coming up next Saturday, a triple header here on ESPN. I think you're going to like this one a lot. Michigan and Wisconsin in the Big Ten. 12:30 Eastern time is the start. Then we go to CFA primetime. West Virginia, number 17, against the same Orangeman team from Syracuse. And then the late game at 10:30 Eastern time, Arizona, number 7 against number 19, UCLA. You can see all three right here on ESPN next Saturday.
Rose Bowl. I think that game will decide who goes to the Rose Bowl, Arizona, UCLA.
Mike, I was amazed when I looked at the national standings this week, and in rushing defense, in 6 ball games, Arizona averages giving up 6.3 yards per ball game.
That's phenomenal.
That's just incredible. I thought it was a mistake, and then I went back and checked another number, and it is right. With a good fake. He's going up on top. Collision. That's going to be pass interference. As Harrison was collided with at the 15-yard line.
And Harrison's going to talk to Carlos Jones, number 12, and tell him that he committed the foul. Marvin Harrison can run. George DeLeon said that he's the star of the future for the Syracuse Orangemen, number 8. Marvin Harrison. There's the push by the right arm of number 12, Carlos Jones.
Hit him right in the middle of the back. You're right.
He didn't think anybody could see that right arm. Syracuse still has two timeouts, around 107 on the clock.
So with the penalty, it will push it to the Miami 44-yard line and 67 seconds left until halftime. Very few penalties in this ballgame. Martin steps up, going to be hit, and it's Baraka short. He makes the sack. Three sacks of Marvin Graves in his first half.
Well, when your front four just continues to hammer your quarterback.
So there's a timeout called by Syracuse. We'll take it with him with 54 ticks left until the halftime.
Good news. Now when you buy Subway steak and cheese sub.
A good look at Collins down on the sideline. What an upset in the Big Ten today for the Fighting Illini. Well, congratulations to Coach Pepper and his staff. Graves zings it and incomplete.
Here's what I was talking about, Ron, just before the timeout. Melvin Tootin, you see number 74, how he's backing up because he's been attacked so much by the front four. That's Baraka Short, number 50. Now we're going to watch Baraka Short pass rushing against Melvin Tootin on Marvin Graves. Now watch him spin to the inside, beat him inside, make the tackle on Marvin Graves.
As we mentioned earlier, Marvin Graves is a very tough football player, but he has really taken some shots tonight. Third down, and they need the 34-yard line. Safety pass, Marcus Lee dropped it. So that stops the clock with 43 seconds, and now what appeared to be a good opportunity for Syracuse maybe to get some points, Miami's going to get the football back.
You have to credit the Miami defense because they just bend a little bit, but they never break. In this ball game, they've been able to just hold Syracuse.
Mike, Jamie German, who is a freshman from Fort Myers, is back in a single safety. This is a guy that Dennis said they want to get him the football. So he's been hurt some with a hamstring. Finally 100%. You can believe they've got another flyer. Well, he is. So he gets a chance to return this one. No, O'Deal's kick is a great one. Very high. Bounding at the five and going into the end zone. So we'll catch his act sometime later. Here are some numbers rushing tonight in the first half. Syracuse, 20 carries, 41 yards for 2.1. Miami rushing, 20 carries, 161 yards and an average of 8.1 per rush.
Here's been the story of the first half, Ryan Collins, 6 out of 7. But beyond that, big decisions that he's made tonight for the Miami offense. He's given the spark that they needed on offense to put 28 on the board.
Go up on top, and that one will be picked off. Tony Jones, number 18, he was the deep center field player, makes his third interception of the year, and Syracuse will take it back with 26 seconds left until halftime.
Well, Tony Jones, a big free safety. You see the cast on his left hand, still was able to make that interception, but he gives you an imposing player in the middle of the field. He's 6'3", 200 pounds, number 18. Just playing center field, a badly thrown ball by Ryan Collins. Dennis Erickson just wanted to air one out before half.
Yeah, but you get to throw the post, if you got a deep safety as deep as he was, you can't throw that route, can you?
No, and you just saw the results of that.
It was Clausell that he was looking for, the tight end.
But you know, when your defense is playing as well as Miami, you throw it downtown all the time.
You can gamble a lot. You're right.
Make some gambles.
John Reagan over the football with 26 seconds left. See Marley taking the blitz, and they go with a running play. Now Wooten to the sideline will be knocked out of bounds at the 39, 21 seconds on the clock.
This Miami defense hits everything that moves on that field.
Wooten is slow to get up as the Miami trainers come over to him first, which was the case with Bennett on the other side of the field. The training staff's always very quick to help out the other team.
Looks like his left knee gets caught up, Ron, a little bit, or ankle. Right around the bench area, Al Wooten, number 38.
Well, this is good news. He's up, and you can see jogging back to the far side of the field. Well, coming up at halftime, the Delta Fawcett Report. Notre Dame and SC, North Carolina and Virginia in a big one today, and a huge upset in the Big Ten.
A huge upset, huh?
I'm telling you. If I had told you earlier today that the Illini would trip up Michigan, what would you have said, Mike?
I would have said, there's no way. And I would have been wrong.
We could be joined by several million people. That's right. That's a great win for the Illini. Being hit, the ball is thrown complete and dropped by Shelby Hill, and now he kicks it off the field of play, and he'll be penalized 15 yards for it.
Well, that's the frustration that goes with a senior receiver. Shelby Hill said he came back this year because Marvin Graves was back. Said he wouldn't have come back if Marvin Graves wouldn't have been the quarterback.
Conduct on the offense.
And he said, I talk all during the game, so you know he's talking to those defensive backs all the time, and Miami's talking to him, and has a chance for a completion here and drops the football, and then he's a little bit better kicking it. There's the story of the game, Ron.
Under pressure, Lewis. Three sacks, five hurries, three knockdowns, and one batted ball. And Mike, on one of those hurries back in the first quarter, you remember that's when the little guy Harrison had his man beaten. That could have been 6 points.
That was a big play by the Miami defense. But the front four have owned this game.
Yeah, they really have. This is Dar Dar. He's been impressive running the ball tonight. That should be the last play of this first half, unless Syracuse calls a timeout. Well, that's the end of the first half with our score. Miami 28 and Syracuse nothing. Stay tuned for the Delta Fawcett halftime report. This is Sigler. Out to the 30-yard line. And here are the numbers on that first 15 minutes, Mike.
And I think the key number is rushing yardage for Miami. Last year when Syracuse had a chance to beat Miami, they limited Miami to 54 yards rushing. In the first half, they've been able to run the ball for 162 yards, 8.1 a carry. And then the pressure on Marvin Graves is the other story.
So the offense scored three touchdowns in the first half for Miami, and the defense scored one. Donnell Bennett, a counter trade. He'll go for 1 yard, and that's it.
The success that Miami has had on the ground tonight, James Stewart has had 9 carries for 95 yards. You see inside, they were able to pound the ball for 59 yards. Outside to the left side is when they went to two tight ends to try to balance up the Syracuse defense and work on Nate Helmsley, the smaller linebacker, 78 yards to that side.
Bennett comes out of the ball game, and again, 28, James Stewart comes in. Was contact made by Syracuse at the line. Unless I miss my guess, KC Jones got bumped by Kevin Mitchell.
Dead ball. Side on the defense.
Contact was made, and let's go down and check in with Adrian Karsten.
All right, Ron, thanks. Hot topic of conversation in the Orangemen's locker room at halftime was how do we protect Marvin Graves? How do we give him more time? Well, coach, your supposition was right. Expect to see more shotgun here in the second half. It's in their offensive package. Plus, they know they're really getting beat by that front four by Miami. Watch the offensive linemen now. They may come to a two-point stance. Hey, giving away the fact they are going to throw the ball, but go right to their pass block technique.
Quick pass and incomplete as Jonathan Harris couldn't hold on to that one, a drop.
Now Ryan Collins tonight in the first half was 6 of 8 throwing the football, but the main thing that he brought to the table tonight was the spark of the offense in the first half. They really were sharp, even with the week off that they had the open date. The offensive team looks very sharp tonight with Ryan Collins calling the signals.
That defensive back comes in for Syracuse, Darryl Parker, number 2. Tony Jones playing a very deep center field pass over the middle of this is Larry Jones. Catches it and fights across the 45. He'll have the Miami first down. Hemsley is there to make the tackle.
Another thought that Dennis Erickson might have. This ball game's not over. In Dennis Erickson's mind, ahead 28-0, he wants to still air the ball out a little bit because he's got Temple next week coming in here. And Ryan Collins, he just wants to get him as much work as he can against this defensive football team of Syracuse.
I asked him what the biggest surprise about this football team was so far this year, and he agreed. The offensive line and the job that they've done, both run blocking and pass blocking. On first down, right across the middle, it's German. Jamie German breaks the tackle, and he'll go to the 34. Tony Jones puts the stopper on him, but that's the young freshman speedster I talked about, finally over his hamstring.
Talented player, Ron, and this series, again, is not just for the Syracuse defense to look for, but this is for Ryan Collins. They want to open this game up because they want him to get enough work in this game, build his confidence and the confidence of his teammates in Ryan Collins as the quarterback. Just a little short throw to Jamie German, number 7. You're right, Ron. He makes things happen after he catches the football.
Boy, did he ever. He only weighs 174, but you can see him put his head down, and he went after people. Collins. This time to Harris, and Jonathan is inside the 15-yard line. It is first and 10 Miami, 23 yards.
It's almost like Rich Olson, the offensive coordinator, and Dennis Erickson said, hey, let's just air it out with Ryan Collins. Let's build some confidence and we're ahead 28-0. This is the best look he's going to get for a while. Let's see what he can do. Jonathan Harris coming over the middle, wide open. Good play fake by Ryan Collins off of the running game. When you establish your running game like Miami has, the play action really comes off of it beautifully.
Mike, here they come again with that formation of the two tight ends.
Two tight ends. They're going to look for number 41 on the left side.
Donnell Bennett, you see the tackle pulling, but penetration. That play is going to be dropped for a loss, and Bennett was hit by Helmsley.
Well, Nate Helmsley's tired of getting picked on that side. He brought him blitzed. A good call by Kevin Coyle, the defensive coordinator. He came from the back door. They moved him on the other side. Now he's coming from behind the pulling tackle and pulling guard. Nate Helmsley makes the tackle on Donnell Bennett, number 33.
Inside the 20 tonight, a lot of people call the red zone. Some people say from the 30 in, but anyway, regardless of which you pick, Miami is 3 of 3 tonight.
And that's what they wanted, touchdowns, not field goals. That's what they wanted Ryan Collins to deliver. Watch a draw here.
Yeah, I think they got caught with delay of game there. Well, as we mentioned, the Bruins went on top 20-17, and that one is now final. So next week from the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, Arizona, and UCLA.
I can tell you exactly in that locker room tonight, Terry Donahue's with his football team telling, hey, we got by this one. That's what we needed to do, just get by. Now we got to lace it up for Arizona and Dick Tomey because they are a great football team.
I have a feeling that Tomey might have said the same thing because they got by in theirs.
You think he said, we've got to lace it up because we're going to play UCLA, a great football team.
Yep, probably so.
And they go with the draw play. And Donnell Bennett, caught by the ankles this time, will be dropped at the 16. It's Hemsley again.
Well, Nate Helmsley's really playing
Hemsley, number 41. He's really like a strong safety playing linebacker at 6 foot, 206 pounds. Very active. Kevin Coyle, the defensive coordinator, said he's the playmaker of our defense. Very tough football player.
Miami. Just under 11 minutes to play, third quarter. Third down, and the Canes can pick up a first down at the 1 yard line. Pick up the linebackers on a blitz. Collins goes for the end zone, got a man. Did he have possession? Touchdown, A.C. Tellison.
The flag on the field, Ron. What a throw by Ryan Collins. Might come back, but what a throw.
Holding against Miami.
On the offense, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, replay third down.
Ball pass, Bologna sends in one of his defensive charges, as you could see Dennis Erickson sending 33 Donnell Bennett in with the play.
Now you have two thoughts right here if you're Dennis Erickson. Air one out and try to get the touchdown back, or just a little short throw and see what you can pick up after the short catch and then set your field goal kicker up.
Syracuse coming on a blitz again. Backside pressure, and that one is well overthrown as he got taken down by Doug Womack.
Brought a defensive back, Doug Womack, number 10, former quarterback, 5'10", 171, a senior.
So rather than a touchdown, let's take one more look at it.
Well, here you see Syracuse give him a different look. Now, again, you're playing with a fresh or a young quarterback. Little delayed blitz by number 10, Doug Womack, and Ryan Collins never was able to see Doug Womack on his left side.
His field goal attempt will be 48 yards. Pruitt. Gonna be short.
But that was
and
blocked.
It was touched or blocked partially by Syracuse. We'll get a number. It was Dwayne Joseph. Let's take a break. National championship, and that one went awry. There's Jesse Armstead to the right, and Terrence Smith just on the other side of him. A couple of former players at the back. Two of several down on the sideline tonight. As Marvin Graves wanted to fake it, take it down the line at the option, and couldn't even get out of the blocks as Sapp was there.
Well, that's what I talked about in the open, is Warren Sapp and those tackles. They just fire the gaps. They just want to disrupt the whole play. And when you're 6'3", 300 pounds, and just firing in that guard center gap, you disrupt a lot of things. Warren Sapp reminds the coaches here of Jerome Brown, the great defensive tackle that played here at Miami.
He is from Plymouth, Florida, and he looks more like the size of Plymouth Rock.
He might be bigger.
Option to the near side. They pitch on the reverse. Shelby Hill detained for a moment, now hit in the backfield, and it's Ray Lewis. Let's go down to Adrian Thurston.
Even though he didn't pick up many yards there, Ron, at least we're seeing a more confident Shelby Hill out here. Believe it or not, Michael Irvin actually came over from the Miami side and was coaching him up just prior to the end of halftime, saying, you know, stay disciplined, run out your routes. He's thinking he's running those two a little bit too short. Secondly, he said, remember back in the first half when he kicked the ball out of frustration, he said, don't ever do that in this stadium again. You get the 15-yard flag, but one way or another, this defense is going to remember and make you pay for that kind of thing.
Well, there was part of the pavement right there. That's a loss of 11 yards. Hit hard and breaks away. How, I don't know, and lofts this one. And it's intercepted down at the 31 by Terrace Harris. And you know what, Mike? Just try and put the pressure on. It might be as good or better than the punt.
Exactly. Now, it's a good play by Marvin Graves, but Marvin has to be thinking that Miami has 14 players on defense because he has about seven chasing him. Then when he looks downfield, there's seven more in coverage. Crine, number 91. Darren Crine, the defensive end, is going to come in and get knocked down. But remember what the Syracuse coaches talked about. And you see somebody almost pulling down. He's down on his knees, gets back up, puts pressure on Marvin Graves, and gets to him just as he throws the football.
Mike, I'm trying to get, that was 35, I think that was 55 yards in the air, so it was as good as a punt for that matter, because there was no return. As James Stewart is hit in the backfield and knockdown. Kevin Mitchell is down at the bottom of the stack, and now here come flags, and we have fisticuffs between two of the players. Casey Jones and Wilkie Bazile are the two players involved, I believe. We know that Jones is, and 70 was pulled off the fray.
Wouldn't be surprised if they throw him right out of the ball game here, the way the fighting has taken over.
Dead ball, personal foul, late hit on the defense. For dead ball, personal foul, late hit on the offense. Will offset, dead ball foul, to be third down.
Let's go down to Adrian Karsten. Adrian?
Ron, we got to remember something here now. A couple weeks back, Colorado, Miami, nowhere near as bad as that was, but Dennis Erickson has said, quote, as head coach, I am responsible for the actions of our players. I feel something has got to be done to control that type of behavior during games. Asking about it, he said he may even get close to something like the NCAA basketball teams do, suspending some of his guys if they come off the bench to fight.
Adrian, I think that's the answer football's going to have to adopt. If they do it once, it's a one-game suspension. Twice, see you for the year. You're gone. That'll make you think before you do it. They set the screen to the left side. Bennett, and look at Mitchell run him down from behind. That is an All-American play by a defensive lineman if we've seen one here tonight.
Kevin Mitchell red screen right away, and there's a linebacker playing down. I mean, he is so agile. He's able to make the play. See number 50 down. He's going to read screen in double team. He sees it's a screen. Now he's able to come off and make the tackle on Donnell Bennett. Ron, I want to just go back to what you said. I thought the referees did a nice job on that. It wasn't really a fight. I mean, it was a little mix-up. And when you're, this is not dancing out here. I mean, there's some contact. Right. So referees did a nice job, and it's over. But like I said, I wouldn't be surprised anymore when it just even starts to try to throw two guys out.
I agree with you. Going downtown. A.C. Tellison at the 18-yard line.
Big plays, Ron, and that's what number 8, Ryan Collins, is delivering. The spark of the offense, and now the deep throw to A.C. Tellison. But watch him stand in the pocket. Calm, gets pressure by Nate Hemsley. He's able to put the ball up right over the shoulders of A.C. Tellison against Bryce Bevel, number 3.
Case, you have just joined us again. It's a 45-yard play. Miami 28 and Syracuse nothing. In fact, Miami led by this score with just over 11 minutes to play in the first half. So Syracuse defensively has really closed the door on them now for about 13 minutes. On to a wide open Clausell at the 1, and he will not get in.
And this is a different agenda for Miami in the second half. It's not only an agenda to score points, but it's centered around Ryan Collins. They want his confidence just to build. They're letting him throw the football. Success they had in the first half running the football. Now they're trying to work on the rest of the season with Ryan Collins, number 8, just giving him some confidence. Good throw. Good protection. Dietrich Clausell, number 83, trying to get it across the line.
Bennett and Harris are set in the I formation. And we go straight ahead with the quarterback sneak, and Collins has just scored the touchdown.
Quarterbacks, as Ryan Collins starts tonight, how many quarterbacks do you think have been a part of this streak? I mean, there's probably 5-6 quarterbacks right here in Miami that's been a part of this streak.
It'd have to be. We can go back and total it for you.
I appreciate it.
That is the first career touchdown by Collins, as the extra point by Pruitt is downtown. So let's take a break. Miami 35, Syracuse nothing.
There's no place on earth that I'd rather be than out in the open where it's all plain to see. If it's gonna get done, it's up to you and me. Come on and head for the mountains of bush. Come on and head for the mountains of bush. Beer.
The average Grand Prix lasts but a few hours, unless it's a Grand Prix started with a genuine Delco Freedom battery. Delco's rated tops for taking the pole position in starting power and excelling in reserve capacity. Helps keep your engine in the race for a longer, more reliable life.
AC Delco. It's like buying time. Now through December 4th, get started with up to $14 cash back on Delco Freedom batteries.
Can you find the Oldsmobile in this picture? We'll give you another try. Here's a hint. It's competition red, has four-wheel anti-lock brakes, and a hot V6 engine. It's the Achieva Sport Coupe. Surprise. It's your money.
Next Saturday, Marvin Graves and the Syracuse Orangemen take on West Virginia in an important Big East battle, live on ESPN.
Good look at Collins on the sideline, his first career touchdown.
And Ron, I think you were right on the number of quarterbacks. I think it is six, and you were right.
Well, here they are. 53 wins, six quarterbacks. Benny Testaverde, 10-0. Jeff Toretta, 1-0. Steve Walsh, Craig Erickson, at 24 wins between those two. Then Gino Toretta and Frank Costa, 2-0. And tonight there could be a seventh quarterback added into that streak.
Ron, you just looked at Frank Costa. I think he'll play in this game tonight. And again, now you have two quarterbacks here at Miami capable of taking your team to a win.
Scott Barnwell. And this is Kirby Dardar from the 10. Literally hurdled the tackler at the 20-yard line. It brought it to the 24 for a 16-yard return.
You're going to win the Big East. You got to beat Miami. And I don't believe there's anybody in the Big East that can beat Miami, Ron.
And I think you're right. Mike, on that drive, Collins was responsible for 65 of the 66 yards. And the drive itself, five plays, 66 yards, 213, and a key play, that 45-yard pass to Tillison.
Syracuse needs to go back and start with a running game again because pass protection just breaks down. Start with running the football. Try to slow this defense down a little bit.
This is Dardar. Here at the line of scrimmage, it's Klein, who's holding him from behind.
We've seen a lot of good football teams this year, Ron. This is one of them.
Well, there's no doubt about that, and it's the thing that really becomes scary when you look at just the wealth of talent as far as running backs and wide receivers. Once Collins or whoever they settle on a quarterback, and it appears it will be Collins, once they get this thing oiled and going, I mean, they could be scary.
It'd be interesting. We're going to put John Junker in here at Fiesta Bowl, and we'll talk about Florida State, Notre Dame. Can Miami get back in the picture?
There's the screen. Tipped and almost intercepted. Kevin Patrick was right there. Patrick is the one who caused the defensive touchdown back in the first half that Kenny Holmes made the interception, and he almost caused another one.
They're so well coached that they're pressuring the quarterback all the time. Then you figure we'll slow him down a little bit with a screen. Kevin Patrick was watching the block of the tackle. He knew it was a little different, so he was reading screen all the way and almost intercepted the ball.
And you know, he's played so well tonight, we have really not mentioned the fact that Patrick is playing with an injured right shoulder. Had to have a left one work on last year, but
and didn't practice on Thursday.
tips it, almost picked off that time as Terrace Harris cut across. Chenoweth is the man that he wanted, and it's three downs and out for Syracuse. German, and this time German should have an opportunity to return the kick. Last time the punt by O'Neill was so good and high that there was no chance. And this one's the same way, down at the 25 yard line. So let's take a break. 35 to nothing the Hurricanes.
Medical negligence. No one wants it to happen, but it happens, sometimes with devastating results. What if it happened to you? How would you know? Who can help you find out? Walsky and Blue. With over 25 years of medical negligence experience, Walsky and Blue can help you answer these questions and will work hard to see that you receive all compensation to which you are entitled. If you suspect you've been the victim of medical malpractice, call the law firm of Walsky and Blue at 228-6969 to arrange for a free consultation.
Model year closeout. Your window of opportunity is closing fast. See your local Better Buick dealer.
Friday, Outside the Lines presents Coaching in the 90s. Stories that will inspire you, others that will shock you, including allegations of sexual misconduct. Outside the Lines, Friday on ESPN.
I'm Chris Berman. Join us on game day tomorrow at noon Eastern Time. We'll show you the new steel curtain with the same effect as the old one. Dion, back into football full-time. And the Colts, 10 years gone from the city of Baltimore, but never forgotten.
There you see the score. It is 5 minutes and 13 seconds left to play in the ball game. And joining Mike Eifert and myself, the gentleman in the beautiful yellow coat right there, John Junker, who is the head guy at the Fiesta Bowl, and we want to discuss scenarios and what possibly could happen. Could Miami get another shot at the number one ranking?
It's very possible, Ron. There's been a lot of excitement in the city of Miami about that this week because of the upsets last week. Very possible with three teams in the top six, Notre Dame, Miami, Florida State, it can happen.
All right, to tell you what we're going to do, we'll go back to play here, but we'll show you the coalition of the top six and how they stand. As Collins throws over the middle. And that will be enough for the first down to the 36-yard line. And here is the coalition top six. All right, we got Florida State, Notre Dame, Ohio State, Nebraska, Alabama, and Miami. Talk about the possibility.
Now, in the next 5 weeks, of course, are the key games coming up in college football, and losses or ties by Ohio State, Nebraska, Alabama. Miami, especially with this performance tonight, is going to move ahead. Okay. If they're 1-2, it's going to happen on January 1st.
In other words, once Florida State and Notre Dame play, if Miami moves all the way up to number two, and Florida State or Notre Dame remains number one, which they will, where would they play the championship game at?
They must play in the IBM OS2 Fiesta Bowl in Tempe.
So they have to play in the Fiesta Bowl. Okay, if Miami ends up number three, and Ohio State or Arizona would happen to be number two, Notre Dame, Florida State, number one, what's the scenario there?
The coalition contract, Mike, calls for those games to be split up, but I know there's going to be a tremendous amount of national interest in the possibility of a 1-3 matchup, especially if there's a member outside the coalition.
One other question, John. If Notre Dame and Florida State, when they play, if one of those two teams were number two and it ended up 1-2, would there be a rematch of that game?
If it can be played, it must be played, even if it's a rematch. And that's entirely possible if the voters think that those two teams are the two best teams in college football.
Okay. If Alabama ends up number two, where would they play the championship game, either Notre Dame, Florida State versus Alabama?
That would go then to the Sugar Bowl.
Nebraska, if they ended up number two?
To the Orange Bowl if it's Florida State or Notre Dame, 1 or 2.
Okay, so what... to give a summation on this. If Florida State or Notre Dame is number one and Miami number two, then the game is going to be at the Fiesta Bowl. Florida State, Notre Dame against Alabama number two, that'll be at the Sugar as that pass is thrown complete. If Nebraska is number two and either Florida State or Notre Dame is number one, it's the Orange Bowl. And Ohio State against what, either Florida State or Notre Dame? And what is the other scenario, though, as far as number two, that what happens then?
In that case, the coalition would split up the teams according to the contract, but we know there'd be a tremendous amount of national interest in behalf of a 1-3 type of matchup down the road, and those are adjustments that you think might be made down the road.
John, you do a great job at the Fiesta Bowl, and of course, I think you're one of the best, and we'll say that you do get the national championship game, that's fine, but what if you don't? Where are you looking for your teams at this stage of the season? I mean, what teams catch your eye?
You know, Mike, there's a number of great teams still out there. Of course, West Virginia's still unbeaten, and they're going to continue to move up in the polls. Virginia had a big win today. There's a lot of interest in the Big Eight. They have three strong teams there, Colorado, Nebraska, Oklahoma, and on the West Coast, of course, Arizona and UCLA look quite strong.
Well, the worst thing in the world that could happen to you is in South Bend in November to have a tie, isn't it?
That could be exciting because maybe we could do the overtime in Tempe.
John, my last thing is, I know that you're part of the coalition. You can't comment on it, but I think it stinks. I really, as a football coach and a former coach, I always thought when you started the season, it's great. You'd have the chance to go to the Fiesta Bowl, the Sugar Bowl, all the bowls. Now they're just, they seem to me, they're all selected beforehand with conferences.
Well, Mike, we sure respect your opinion. I'd say two things. Is number one is openness would be great for all of college football, but that would include the tied in bowl berths. Second thing, though, is the coalition has brought a little bit of stability to college football.
Okay, it is second down here. Miami driving, they'll take it to the 10-yard line. We've been visiting with John Junker, and we wish you the very best of luck. Thanks so much for coming by, because there are so many scenarios here, but I think probably more so for two teams in Florida that really get after each other, that there is a possibility that either this team or the team in Tallahassee, that they could even wind up facing each other again.
Absolutely. The next 5 weeks will be really exciting.
John, thanks for coming by. Good luck to you guys.
Thanks to have you on, John. Appreciate you coming.
So, third down, and the line to make is the 4-yard line for Miami. Collins from the shotgun this time, zings it to the end zone. Touchdown, Ty Tucker.
Billy's went to the bullpen the fourth game, got some bad results, but Dennis Erickson went to the bullpen tonight, and he's found himself a closer for the rest of the year. What?
Extra point attempt is down and good as a flag has been thrown on the near side of the field, and let's check that.
Offside on the defense. Point is good. Penalized on the kickoff.
Ty Tucker, the tight end, is just going to release in the flat. Direct snap to Ryan Collins. It's against the linebacker, number 41, Nate Hemsley. Open for the touchdown. Another look, Ryan Collins. Quick delivery, good strong football, good throw to his tight end, Ty Tucker. He's got a quick release, Ron. Ryan Collins.
He really does, and I think the point that you made just a while ago, and that is the fact that they are playing him now to give him some confidence. They're letting him throw the football all over the field. And it's not a thing of Miami trying to run up the score. They're trying to run up the confidence level of a guy that they think is going to carry him the rest of the way.
Well, there's no doubt. You know, he's got a lot of season football to play yet, and the confidence of Ryan Collins is high, but his teammates with him.
Here's an example of that. He has now hit 9 of his last 10. He's 16 to 20, but the fact he's hit 9 of his last 10, he's got one touchdown, he threw an interception, and has just thrown another touchdown pass.
Wouldn't be a bit surprised fourth quarter we see Frank Costa bring him off the bench and let him get a little work also, because I don't know if Ryan Collins can do any more tonight than he's done. He's just had a great game.
In Miami, to show you depth, they've used 9 different receivers. This is Kirby Dardar. And Mike Tirico, what do you have for us?
Hold the phone, Wisconsin. After being stopped on a fourth down in close, Minnesota gets the ball back up 7. Scott Eckers to Rashawn Early. Gets away from the secondary, breaks free. They punch it in from a yard out. Wisconsin has just turned it over, and they're in deep trouble.
Well, the Big Ten has already produced the biggest wow of the day, and they're about to produce the second, I would say.
It'd really be a big upset there at Minnesota.
It'd be a huge win for Jim Wacker and his program.
Sometimes your teams look ahead a little bit. You talk to them. You try to show them that no matter who you're playing on a given day, like Arkansas State today with a big tie against Mississippi State, which was a big game for them. I mean, you just constantly have to stay on your football team, as you see Frank Costa, number 11, warming up.
And I think, Mike, you'll hear a very warm reception from this crowd here, because they like this young man and they know he's played well. Make the draw. Marvin Graves going to be hit and is sacked for the fourth time.
Story of the ball game, Ron, is they have not been able to protect the quarterback. Dwayne Johnson, who's a backup defensive tackle now, 6'5", 267-pound junior. He's fresh. Number 94, there he is, roaring up the field again, beating the block of Cy Ellsworth. Able to make the sack, getting help from Quan Russell, number 45. They just keep coming.
I'm sure it's the last thing those offensive linemen for Syracuse want to see, is a fresh jersey coming onto the field with that kind of athletic ability.
That and replay on TV.
Graves puts this one on top. Intercepted and then fumbled and recovered again by Terrace Harris. His second interception.
Marvin Graves just tried to air it out. He's trying to get something started. Tried to hit Shelby Hill down the sideline, but looked like Shelby Hill kind of gave up on the route a little bit, because the ball was thrown so far down the field. Terrace Harris, number 6. Now you see Shelby Hill pull up. Now he becomes a defensive player. Causes the fumble, but Terrace Harris recovers.
Mike, just what I said. Listen to the reaction for Costa. I mean, these people know that he has not played badly, but it was just a coach's decision. But they're very much in his corner, and I think that's a great thing for the youngster to hear that kind of ovation. Frank, a junior from Philadelphia, 6'4", 220. Hemsley is there to make the stop.
You have to let Frank Costa throw the football, too. There's his yards, 1,046, 4 touchdowns, 51% of his passes completed, 3 interceptions.
And that is the end of the third quarter. So we'll take a timeout. Miami 42, Syracuse nothing.
Some people are naturally faster than others. In fact, everything they do is fast. Fast, 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 fast. Now, not everyone appreciates that. But if you're looking to get a new GM car or truck financed, fast is exactly what you want.
Mac will take care of your financing.
And the folks who arrange GMAC financing and leasing are faster than just about anyone else. GMAC, the expressway home.
You forgot your sunglasses.
Can you find the Oldsmobile in this picture? We'll give you another try. Here's a hint. It's competition red, has four-wheel anti-lock brakes, and a hot V6 engine. It's the Achieva Sport Coupe. Surprise? It's your money.
Delta Faucet has over 1,000 different styles of faucets to choose from.
Wait, just a sec.
So there's a Delta Faucet that's right for everyone's needs.
Ooh. Okay, I'll get the food, you get the water.
Delta, the way water is brought to life.
And don't forget to turn it off.
The average Grand Prix lasts but a few hours, unless it's a Grand Prix started with a genuine Delco Freedom battery. Delco's rated tops for taking the pole position in starting power and excelling in reserve capacity. Helps keep your engine in the race for a longer, more reliable life.
AC Delco. It's like buying time. Now through December 4th, get started with up to $14 cash back on Delco Freedom batteries.
You know, there's one thing that most sporting events have in common. When you see this R, the player's wearing a Russell Athletic NFL Pro-Line jersey.
I won.
Hey, Joe.
Russell Athletic is also the official uniform supplier of Major League Baseball. They even have in most major college and high school teams. In fact, Russell Athletic even makes great sweats and tees for the rest of us. Unfortunately, not everybody's gotten to work.
Russell Athletic. It's everything we make that makes our sweats and tees so great.
Ready for the final 15 minutes of play as the Miami Hurricanes have proven that, they got a pretty good mat on after losing to Florida State, and they are manhandling a Syracuse ball club that came in here 4-1. In fact, in the third quarter, to show you how the manhandle continued, Miami 189 yards in the third quarter, Syracuse 18 total yards. Swings out the pass. Harris can't hold on. Let's go down to Adrian Karsten. Adrian?
Ron, a little bit of pride here in the Miami sideline with the very proud parents of tonight's starting quarterback for the Miami Hurricanes. Sam Collins, was he feeling any pressure coming into his very first start for the Hurricanes? The winning streak, you know, the Walshes, the Ericksons, the Jim Kellys. What were his thoughts?
Well, Ryan really was confident. I felt the pressure, you know. Being in the stands watching, it's really more pressure on us than him. You know, he's used to playing in big games. He played in big games in high school, and he's a very confident young man.
What do you think he brings to tonight's game that maybe Frank Costa doesn't?
Mobility. You know, that's what the coach said, and I think that's the big difference.
Gary, you mothered the boy for crying out loud. He's having a pretty successful night, isn't he?
Certainly is. Yes, he is.
His future, what do you expect to happen here now at the Hurricanes as the streak continues? A star is born tonight, perhaps?
I think Ryan will take each game as it comes and try to perform to his best of his ability. And if anything happens after that, it happens. But his major goal now in college is to get that degree in accounting.
Sam and Kerry, thank you very much. Ron, I think the mother's got it right. One game at a time.
One game and an accounting degree. And that sounds like a good priority list to me. 16 of 20, 206 yards. And the shoulder pads are on. He's done for this evening. Shelby Hill back to fair catch this one, and he makes it at the 41. So there's a break in the action. Let's take it with him. We'll be back to the Orange Bowl after this.
About 65 miles south of the nearest stoplight and 2 miles up in the Rocky Mountain sky, you'll find skiers heaven, also known as Telluride. The skiing's perfect and the views are even better. And whether you're going to extremes or just going for a lesson, don't go without your Visa card. Because at Telluride Ski Resort, they'll let you take the plunge, but they won't take American Express. Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
99 years ago, we built our first Kelly Springfield tire. In that time, Americans invented TV. We fought in 2 world wars. We flew the first airplane.
The Miami record. Williams was a 91 first team All-American. Kevin Mason has come to the ball game at quarterback. He's a junior. Thrown 6 passes this year, completed 3. And it's Dardar with a running play who will go straight ahead. And let's check the numbers as it looks as though that Marvin Graves will be done for the evening. And it was just a night where it's impossible to get anything done when you got as many bodies hanging on you as Marvin did throughout the evening.
Instead of counting sheep tonight, he'll be counting Miami defensive players. 6 out of 20 completions, 59 yards, 3 interceptions. But fairness to him, he did not have any time. His protection tonight, Miami dominated.
Just impossible to throw under the conditions he had. Wants to run the option. Pressure coming here on Mason. And he's going to scramble it and have the first down. Pick up 5 yards more just inside the 45. Now, there are the numbers on him. Mike, we were watching him before the ball game and just commenting on the fact he throws the ball very, very nicely. He's a good size at 6'3", but just the question comes back is, you know, as good as Marvin is, he had an impossible time of throwing, having people draped on his body. Can Mason, you know, can he do anything different with people hanging on him?
No. Now, let me tell you another thing, Ron, is it's difficult for Syracuse to get Kevin Mason in the football game because most of their games this year have been close football games. Yeah. So Kevin Mason, as you look at the numbers, hasn't had a lot of opportunity to play when you're playing behind a great quarterback like Marvin Graves.
Well, that's right, because, you know, with the exception of the Ball State game, that East Carolina game was in doubt up until the second half. The tie with Texas, Cincinnati, they had to come from behind. Boston College, they lost. And the Pittsburgh game was so close last week at 24-21.
Kevin Mason, this is probably his first chance with a lot of time, especially against a great defense, to play.
Wishbone set. You see the pressure, and the snap is an errant one. And on the ground, Richardson will make the recovery. Well, Mike, let's take a look at our top 10, and this is the way we see them this week.
Florida State 1, Arizona 1. Again, you said they had some injuries. We'll come back to that. Notre Dame, just a powerful, powerful football team. Miami 4, Alabama with a win over Ole Miss. Ohio State rolled on against Purdue. Nebraska wins, Texas A&M wins, Tennessee's off, and UCLA again, and we have UCLA and Arizona. Now, Arizona's Mike Tirico tried to put the eraser to them last week, but they're still up there.
You know, Butch Henry, the sports information director at Arizona, told me on Wednesday evening that both of the starting tackles for Arizona were injured and neither were going to be able to go in that ballgame. So maybe that's the reason they struggled a little bit offensively.
I think Arizona is the Alabama of last year. Great defensive football team that plays for their offense, plays to the defense.
Maybe exactly right. Got this one complete at the 40, and Wilson off to the races and will be tackled at the 23-yard line by Carlos Jones.
Well, Kevin Mason used great patience on this play to wait till Jason Wilson was able to come open.
32 yards, Mike.
Direct snap off the shotgun, which gives him a little bit longer to throw. Number 94, Dwayne Johnson, fell down. Number 6, Jason Wilson is able to come open. Carlos Jones, number 12, makes the tackle.
Straight ahead, tackled at the 20.
It's that pride factor again about the home streak in the Miami defense, because the crowd now is getting back into the game. The players on the field, the starting defensive guys are up, encouraging the defense. They do not want to give up the shutout.
Will Walker will come into the lineup at the wide receiver. Play to the wide side of the field, and Kryan again catches him from behind. Boy, just any hesitation, and Kryan with his quickness, he's just eating the quarterbacks up tonight.
And again, Ron, Darren Kryan just able, he's relentless, just to continue to pressure down the line of scrimmage, make tackle. See, he's able to come across the line of scrimmage, now get flat right away. Flat. He doesn't get deep in the backfield where he has to come back. He's flat, just good pursuit angle.
You know, it's Kryan who's shaken up a little bit, and it may have been the fact that Sapp, who was a 300-pounder, kind of came down and made him hit his shoulder at a not-so-good angle.
And I'm kind of surprised he's in at 42-0. So, you know, I'm sure they're going to get him out of there. Well, what a tough player. Darren Kryan, Kevin Patrick on both sides, bookends. You think he's seen his last play for tonight at 10:24 to go on the clock?
You know what? If Syracuse gets down here and gets any closer to score, I bet you all four of them try to come back in.
Well, they'll make him take his shoulder pads off, so if he goes back in, he'll have to play without them.
You remember last year, the West Virginia game here, though, when all of a sudden when Don Nealon's team started coming back and there were people putting shoulder pads back on to the sideline.
And that's sure, I'm sure that's what Dennis Erickson and Tommy Tuberville are thinking, the defensive coordinator. They don't want to give up too quick here. It's tough to score 42 points in 10 minutes against this team.
Oh, I know that. I just wanted to know if you remembered what happened last year against West Virginia. Pressure, and he's going to be sacked. This is sack number 6, and it's the other side of the bookends. It's Kevin Patrick. And let's go down to the sideline and Adrian Karsten.
Ron, thanks very much. With Bob Blackman, who is chairman of the selection committee for the East-West Shrine Game, we're talking about Mr. Patrick first. I know you're looking at Crine as well. What do you see in these two players? Patrick, first of all.
They both look outstanding. Patrick is so very quick. On the snap of the ball, Patrick and Crine have met right back there at Martin and Graves. Almost immediately, and they're both playing almost equally, and it's a very difficult choice between the two of them.
You can only take one. Who do you pick at this point?
Probably we are so limited in an all-star game, and right now I just couldn't make a decision. I know we're going to invite one of them, and I just don't know which one yet.
Don't want your job, Bob. Thanks very much.
All right, no problem.
Adrian, thanks a lot. He's a special guy, very good head coach at Illinois, at Princeton, and also at Cornell, isn't he?
Right. Good, solid person.
Mason to run, makes one miss, and then will be knocked out of bounds, and the fourth down will not pick up the first down for Syracuse. Well, Mason gave it a good shot. Can't be disappointed in his effort. There's a standing ovation coming from this home house for the defensive unit for Miami.
Ron, remember, if they don't play their bowl game here in the Orange Bowl, win the rest of their games, the Washington Huskies next year will be the team that they could break the streak against.
We'll take a break. We'll be right back.
Presents George Strait.
At GMC Truck, we've built a reputation for truck strengths. A considerable advantage. It also comes in this handy take-home size. Sierra from GMC Truck.
There are lots of reasons to buy life insurance. Here are two great ones. I'm State Farm Agent Mike Foy. As the Goff family has grown, so have their life insurance needs. That's why we get together for family insurance checkups. I make sure to explain all the options, then they decide on the plan that's right for them. Ask your State Farm agent for a family insurance checkup. It's a great way to learn about life.
Next Saturday, Marvin Graves and the Syracuse Orangemen take on West Virginia in an important Big East battle, live on ESPN.
Felt some of the mist coming from those fans across the way on the Syracuse bench. And 8:54 left in the ballgame, 42-0. As you look at Tom Tuberville.
Tom Tuberville, outstanding defensive coach. He's been the coordinator here, took over for Sonny Lubick, called the defenses last year and the year before. When you look at the streak that this Miami football team's put together, 53 here at home, and you compare it to other sports, the Celtics 38 straight, 85-86, the Dolphins right here in town 27, the St. Louis Browns in Major League Baseball, and the Philadelphia Flyers 24 in the National Hockey League. So quite an accomplishment here, Ron, of what they've accomplished, and they're chasing Alabama, who's got the great streak and who's leading at this point.
Trey, this time Larry Jones, and he'll take it for about three right at the middle. Well, now we have had a punch thrown by one of the Syracuse players. Womack is being shown off the field. He has been ejected. He hit one and then hit a second player.
Paul Pasqualoni talking to Doug Womack, and he knows he made a mistake, Ron. You can tell the reaction of Doug Womack as he went off the field. Paul Pasqualoni, a gentleman and a fine football coach at Syracuse with an excellent staff. This is a football team that's still got a lot of football to play this season.
Mike, I'm not sure that Womack was the first one, though. I saw Joseph make a hit first, and then I think that Womack came over to help out his teammate.
Well, you remember early in the game I mentioned they may throw those two guys out that had the first fight. They weren't taking any chances, and I credit the officials. I mean, rather than let a game, this is 42-0, rather than let it get out of hand, toss them. But again, this isn't dancing. There's going to be contact out there.
Rohan Marley has his jerseys off. His jerseys has his shoulder pads off, and one of the
dead ball, personal foul on the defense. Dead ball, personal foul on the offense. We have another dead ball, personal foul on the defense. Two penalties will offset. We'll have a 15-yard penalty against the defense. We have ejections on both teams.
And we have ejections on both teams. So we saw that at number 10, Womack was taken to the sideline, and we'll try to check down on the Miami bench and see who was kicked off.
Both coaching staffs did a real nice job of getting right out in front of their football teams to make sure nobody left the bench area.
Now, wait a minute. I am assuming that somebody from Miami, that it was...
Well, you can see Dennis Erickson is still not very happy with what happened.
Well, he said two ejections now. Remember I mentioned Joseph?
They may have both been on the Syracuse side.
You see, Paul is talking with him. Check in with Adrian very quickly, see what he can help us with here. Adrian?
Right, I am being told it was German who has been ejected. Now, he is very reluctantly making his way to the back of the bench here, helmet off, taking his gloves off. Yeah, it looks like he is done, Ron. So it's German out for Miami.
Okay. So it is Womack, and it is German. Is that right, Adrian?
Sure. You've got it right, Ron.
Okay. Being assessed. So there were three penalties, offsetting, and then there was another. Called against Syracuse, and that's when Womack was kicked out and 15 yards stepped off. Ron Franklin, Mike Gottfried, and Adrian Karsten from the Orange Bowl in Miami, Florida. 42-0. The Hurricanes lead. 8:06 to play in this one.
Syracuse will have to get themselves back together as a football team because they have West Virginia next week at the Dome, an undefeated West Virginia team. It's been impressive this year.
Well, we saw Coach Nealon's team today. Mike, they can march it up and down the field, can't they?
Jake Kelchner's a fine quarterback. Recruited him out of Berwick High School in Pennsylvania.
Pass thrown complete at the 37. That's Alfred Shipman who makes the reception.
Syracuse has West Virginia at home, Temple at home. Then they go to Virginia Tech and at Rutgers. West Virginia game is a key game in the Big East standings. Miami, Temple at home, at Pittsburgh, Rutgers at home. They go to West Virginia and then Memphis State at home. And I think you're looking at the Big East champion here in the Miami team. And of course, that West Virginia game will be the roadblock for them.
Larry Jones breaks the tackle and all almost spins off clear again, this time to the 26. Gary Brannon has come in replacing Bevel at cornerback. He's out of West Palm Beach, and he is there to make the stop. Well, Ryan Collins got spelled late in the third by Frank Costa, and well deserved. Good start for him tonight.
Dead ball, offsides on the defense.
The offside penalty against Syracuse.
Well, this is where we'll be next week for the late game out on the West Coast and see these two players. Ron Waltrip of Arizona State, what an outstanding nose guard, and J.J. Stokes.
Well, they'll be disappointed in Arizona today. They had a rough day. They gave up 68 yards rushing. That's unbelievable. They just have a great defense at Arizona. J.J. Stokes, 8 receptions today, 86 yards and a touchdown.
I apologize for calling him from Arizona State. I know he's from Arizona, but he is a down lineman. He does not play in the middle, as you'll see next Saturday. You'll think that there's more than one playing.
Impact games next week. Ron, this is a big Saturday next week. Penn State's at Ohio State. Ohio State can take another step toward the Rose Bowl. Nebraska, Colorado. This is Nebraska's real test next week as far as the Big Eight. Colorado will be waiting on them after a tie today, and that'll be a tough test for Nebraska.
Well, individual performances tonight. James Stewart, 10 carries for 97 yards and 2 touchdowns. Bennett, 12 carries for 57. Larry Jones, 5 for 49, or whatever he totals right here, and he goes all the way inside the 10. It is a first and goal for Miami as Parker is there to make the stop. And Derek Harris has carried it 4 times for 21 and has scored a touchdown.
Parker and Rebar on the stop. The game was 9 in the World Series.
It's a little give up inside to Larry Jones, number 23. Bounced off some tackles. Up inside for key yardage, and you can tell by this picture that some of the players in Miami have packed it in for the night. Just Casey Jones signing some autographs.
Derek Harris. He'll take it down around the 5-yard line as we're about to go under 5 minutes left in this one.
Syracuse has been so successful in the last few years and winning percentage in their program, and you'll see them in the Big Bowl this year yet.
Mike, this is one of those that you have talked about in the past where if you're Paul, you probably just take this video and maybe not even show it to him, huh?
Yeah, burn it. I mean, you just ran into a real good football team tonight that's hot here in the Orange Bowl.
Jones in the counter. Touchdown, Miami.
5 yards out of a hurricane touchdown.
Of offensive linemen did an outstanding job. Jay Anna, one of them, along with Alan Simonette with the Miami Hurricanes. Extra point that time by Barnwell is good, so we'll take a break. 4:26 left. It is 49-0.
Things you do every 4 years. Vote for president. Watch the Summer Olympics. Celebrate leap year. Buy a new car or truck. Not at Bob Kime Ford, where you can drive new every 2. Bob Kime Ford has the vehicles and the plan that guarantees the future value of your new car or truck after driving it for 2 years. When those 2 years are up, you owe nothing. So you can turn that car or truck in on another new Ford and start it all over again. That's the drive new every 2 plan at Bob Kime Ford, 5300 North High Street, where our customers are twice as smart.
61,
with thousands of brand name parts in stock, you know you'll have the one you need. You can count on it. AutoSource, everything for your car. For less.
20,113.
Well, ma'am.
I know I need a new engine, new batteries, a new headlight, and probably a new thingamajig for the whatchamacallit, right?
Nope. Just a fuse.
Oh.
AutoSource, everything for your car. For less.
Ma'am. 450 javelins. Nice hat. And one coconut. See it. Believe it. Amazing Games, Monday night on ESPN.
You could say he's got a good grip on things. Six birdies, one eagle, one bogey is 765 today. Davis Love III goes for his second victory of this year tomorrow. Join our ESPN golf team for final round live coverage at 5 Eastern.
Well, the Orange Bowl is not even half filled now. They have headed to the exits and into the night lights of this city down here in the southern tip of the state of Florida, because that man's football team, you see him checking his watch. Okay, guys, it's 3 hours old right now. But they changed quarterbacks tonight, trying to find some more offense. Frank Costa went to the bench. Ryan Collins was the starter. And boy, the results were devastating as far as Syracuse is concerned. And Frank Costa came on and did a very good job of leading his football team in the period of time that he's played in Mapa.
Well, he has. I think he's a fine quarterback. Again, it was the fit of the wide receivers were not making the big plays. Dennis Erickson felt the move to the quarterback, Ryan Collins, might spark him and give him more big plays, and that's exactly what's happened tonight.
Marvin Graves with just one of the worst outings he's ever had. But it was, rather than, and we're certainly not putting down the great quarterback from Syracuse, it was as a result of what Tom Tuberville and the Miami defense forced him to do. This is Dardar from the 8. And let's go down and check in with Adrian Karsten.
Backup defensive tackle Dwayne Johnson had about 4 or 5 hits tonight. Tackles wrap up. Ron, he backs up Warren Sapp. Let me ask you something. The Wild Samoans, Superfly Snuka, okay? Looking at Rocky Johnson. This is Dwayne's father. Look at the man come off the ropes. That's what he was known for. He won the tag team title in the World Wrestling Federation. Superfly Snuka right there. I mean, this is one heck of a wrestling town. They got a great college wrestling team here. And look at the Samoans get after it. Rocky Johnson, the tag team title with Tony Atlas in 1984. Now, if your son doesn't make it as a football player, something tells me something else is in genes here.
That's right. I wanted to give him the opportunity to do what he wanted. He said he wanted to try football, and so far he's doing real good. But if ever wants to get into wrestling, I think the old man can still show him a few things.
All right, now let me ask you something. One time in high school, his friends were making fun of him, saying, well, is this wrestling thing, is it real or is it not? And he put a sleeper hold. Now, what's a sleeper hold?
I taught him the sleeper hold. He put the sleeper hold on a guy, and I didn't show him how to wake the guy up. What's a sleeper hold?
Let me show you. Tell everybody
good night. Good night,
Ron. All right. Adrian, well, here's the final score. A sleeper hold was put on the Badgers tonight. You ready for this one? Minnesota 28, Wisconsin 21. That one is in the books. Terry Richardson. And he'll take it for the first down out over the 40-yard line.
Terry Richardson.
The sleeper hold.
Was that the end of Adrian tonight?
Could be out for the year.
We'll give you an update on his condition next week.
In a couple of weeks. About to go under 3 minutes left in this one. Official attendance tonight here at the Orange Bowl, 63,194. 63,194. Nation going deep, and that one's overthrown. Nation looking for Jason Wilson, sophomore out of Tampa.
You know, when we talk Texas football, you talk Darryl Royal, Woody Hayes at Ohio State, the Bear at Alabama, and you talk Syracuse, Ben Schwartzwalder. He was 178-96-3 in 28 years, and in their brochure at Syracuse, John Mackey, the former tight end, had a great line. He said he taught us how to win in life, and then his last sentence was, Ben, we love you. And I think that's the great thing about coaching and players and the relationship you have. And here's John Mackey, a superstar, credits Ben Swartzwalder, great coach of Syracuse, for all that's happened in his life.
The ball is fumbled. It's on the ground at the 45, and now here comes the flag.
Aces, fumbles, penalty markers.
And there's a great look at the great head coach for Syracuse.
Just an outstanding job when he's coaching there, a leader of men, and the coaching profession was very proud of him, and he helped make the coaching profession a solid profession. And this man right here, Paul Pasqualoni, is cut from the same mold and has been very successful there and will continue this program upward.
Third down at 10.
You look at the far sideline and the players, they just can't believe this has happened to them. But some very good teams have come into this place to play in this streak of 53, about to be 54, and the same thing has happened to them. That one's complete to Jason Wilson, and you can see right there the arm that Kevin Mason has on him. He put that one on a rope.
Ron, you talk about the home field and the early schedule next year, going to Arizona State and then having Washington the first home game, then Florida State the second home game. They'll be challenged here next year by those two football teams.
Well, the Hurricanes are 2 minutes and 41 seconds away from getting a shutout. The last shutout here was 48-0 against Temple, and that was last year. Terry Richardson. He'll pick up another first down.
Richardson.
Well, tonight's piece of players of the game for Syracuse, Kevin Mitchell. 9 tackles, 3 solo. And for Miami, it's rare that we do this, but we're going to split it. Darren Krein, and he had 7 tackles, 1 sack, and Kevin Patrick. 4 tackles, 2 sacks. He caused an interception for a touchdown. And as part of their continuing effort to further the development of amateur athletics, Visa proud to donate $1,000 to each of these universities and $1,000 to the U.S. Olympic team on behalf of these athletes. And our congratulations to all of them. Well, he held on to that thing, and now here comes the flag in. Well, I guess he didn't.
I think you'll agree with me. The 3 best football teams we've seen all year, Notre Dame, Florida State, not in that order, of course, and Miami. And, of course, Florida State's already beaten Miami. But Miami may now be a different team with Ryan Collins at the quarterback position. But those are the 3 best teams, would you say?
Yeah, I would. And I still lean toward Florida State after what we've seen of them.
I do, too. And next week we get to see Arizona, which we'll see if they're in that same class. I know we voted them up there, but we'll see next week.
Got a pet.
Baraka Short is the man who is injured, and now he's up and running off on his own.
One thing when you play the University of Miami, they never stop hitting.
Well, particularly some of these guys are just coming in getting an opportunity to play, and they're trying to get a coach to notice them.
They practice hard all week, and they say when we get in this football game, we're going to hit somebody. Marcus Carey, number 48.
He's a senior, Riviera Beach. 2:01 left in the ball game. That's Baraka Short. He's from Opa-locka, a junior, 6'3", 250.
His program since 1987. Miami, of course, 71-6. And look at Syracuse, 60-15-4.
Florida State, Notre Dame, Nebraska, Alabama, and Syracuse. First down following the penalty. Mason with the option, and he'll take it for a couple, and they're tough ones as Robert Bass comes over.
I'd be remiss, too, if I didn't add Alabama in maybe the top four teams we've seen, because we had them against South Carolina. We've seen some good football teams, and we're going to see some more as we go along.
Game was two.
Darren Krein, interesting that he would be one of our student players of the game and also one of our players of the game. Mike, I think you're right on the Alabama choice as far as being in the top four.
A lot of football to play yet.
Good tough run by Richardson. He'll come out of bounds. Clock is stopped at 49.
Coaches about Terry Richardson say he runs downhill. He's a slasher. Of course, the famous number 44, 6'1", 205 senior from here in Florida. Came home to play tonight.
See, Kevin Patrick, you know, what those starters are doing, we had a shot a moment ago of Krein and then of Patrick, and what they're doing is they're hollering to that defense saying, don't give up points. Don't you dare let them in the end zone.
All right, of course, you know the recruiting at Syracuse on the number 44. Great players that have worn it.
Of course, Floyd Little, Ernie Davis, Jim Brown.
And their rushing yardage. You and I were talking about the great running backs of all time. I'd say my favorite's Jim Brown.
Jimmy Brown, a lot of people will say, is the best that ever played. Now, you get a lot of argument. There are people that say O.J., other folks that say Sweetness. But Brown and that combination of Hickerson and Wooten out front was extremely difficult to get in front of or to stop.
Number 32 didn't wear hip pads, and Vince Costello, a linebacker on that team, just told me, he said he was like a Superman in the backfield.
Mason running for his life, gets by one tackler, and then he'll go down hard at the 10. He's close to the first down. Clock is under a minute. We're running down to 35 and 34.
This is all about pride right here with 31 seconds to go, whether Miami's going to allow them in the end zone or Syracuse going to work their way in.
So Syracuse takes a timeout. We'll take it with them. 25 seconds left in the ball game. We will be right back.
Underneath every new Jimmy is the strength of a strong truck frame. An important advantage for towing, whether you're on-road or off-road. The GMC Jimmy. Drop in for a test drive. At Radio Shack, we've always made the latest technology easy to understand for your family. And now our CD-ROM computers make it easy to bring entire libraries to life. Experience the power of Tandy multimedia computers. Only at Radio Shack.
A new chapter has begun in Merrill Lynch's history in Asia. We are the first American securities firm invited to open an office in mainland China. Being there gives our financial consultants a different perspective, which makes a difference for our clients. The difference is Merrill Lynch.
Welcome back to the Orange Bowl to Miami. Ron Franklin, Mike Gottfried, and Adrian Karsten. 25 seconds left in this ball game, and Miami clearly showing that they, regardless of the defeat to a great Florida State team, are still one of the best, one of the top five teams in this country.
Ron, update on Adrian Karsten. His tie's asleep, and he's awake.
Nothing could put those ties to sleep, even ether. Just as he delivered the football, it is Twan Russell, number 45. another freshman. He is out of Fort Lauderdale.
This could be a taunting call here.
Dead ball, personal foul on the defense.
I think you're right on, Mike.
There's a little talking after that play, and I think that was the call.
Well, coming up next, the college football scoreboard. Two of the big upsets today came in the Big Ten Conference. Michigan fell and Wisconsin fell. Takes the ball to the 6-yard line. They'll put five more back on there. Looked like Ken Warren came out of his stance a little too quickly.
Ball start on the offense.
Ron, you know the coach who started this whole thing in Miami, is Drew Carr-Snellenberg, of course, was the first coach to win the national championship, but it was really Lou Saban who came here for 2 years and along with coaches like Ron Marcinak, built the team, recruited guys like Jim Kelly, and of course then he left and Howard came in and started it all here.
Going for the end zone on this one, overthrown. Will Walker is the man that he wanted. 14 ticks left on the clock.
A lot of bumping going on there between Earl Little, number 15, who signed at Michigan and then left there at two-a-days when the hurricane hit down here and came back to school here at Miami and walked on, and they gave him a scholarship immediately and been successful since. 6'1", 185-pound freshman. Listen to these fans around. They do not want them in the end zone.
Dead ball. Encroachment on the offense.
And last year, they were 3 yards away from beating Miami up at the Dome.
Tonight they're 3 miles.
Second down and goal at the 15.
Frustrating when you prepare a team to come in here and you get whipped 49-0.
No doubt about it.
They've whipped a lot of people here and on the road.
Look at the blitz coming up the middle, and Mason is going to be knocked down for a loss at the 20. Riley is the man who came through. And Syracuse calls a timeout with 4 seconds left. We'll be back.
Tony and Diane get regular insurance checkups just like they get regular medical checkups. I'm State Farm Agent Carlos Bermudez. I have been their State Farm Agent 7 years. A family insurance checkup helps them make sure all their coverages are up to date. It's also a good time to explore options, like how their life insurance plan can be adapted to help with their daughter's college education. I think the family insurance checkup is something everybody can feel good about.
State Farm is there.
We're back 49-0 with 4 seconds left. Syracuse got that last timeout called. See the back of Burgess, who has come in the ball game. So the streak is going to go to 54. No doubt about that. It's just, can they keep them out of the end zone?
The killer instinct of the Miami defense is ready.
Pass is intercepted. Well, that's it from the Orange Bowl of Miami, Florida. But the final score, Miami 49. and Syracuse nothing. For Mike Gottfried, Adrian Karsten, and our entire ESPN crew, this is Ron Franklin saying good night, everybody. The Resident Inn College Football Scoreboard is next.
Floats at Mardi Gras are made right here at Blaine Kern Artists. They make things bigger than life. But for office supplies, they make one call to Office Depot. Office Depot takes care of business for millions of companies throughout North America. From Bourbon Street to Main Street, we guarantee low prices every day.
Hi, is this space taken?
No.
Then I'll sit down.
You want a Bud Light?
Not yet.
Hey, hey, wait a minute! That's my Bud Light!
If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down, make it a Bud Light.
How about a little help here?
Come fly the airline that spans more than half the world. United. Come fly the friendly skies.
Hi there, and welcome to our Residence Inn post-game report. We thank you, each and every one of you, for hanging around. Thank you for your loyalty. Chris Fowler, along with Lee Corso and Craig James. Beano Cook will join us a little bit later on. Let's get right to it. Games played this evening in the WAC. San Diego State's trying to stay with Wyoming as the only unbeaten teams in WAC play. Take it on Los Lobos in San Diego. And David Lowry watching as Tim Gutierrez passes to Darnay Scott over the middle. Look at him bounce outside, down the sidelines. He had been x-rayed earlier for some ribs. X-rays were negative and a very positive play for San Diego State. Even though Lowry is healthy, Gutierrez keeps the starting job. 10-3 San Diego State early in the third quarter. San Jose State and Louisiana Tech 14-3 in the third quarter. Jeff Garcia, 25-yard touchdown pass. Utah State and UNLV, it's now 10-3 as the Run Rebels get a touchdown and go ahead in the second quarter, just 2 seconds into the second quarter. Pacific is hosting New Mexico State right now. The Aggies with a touchdown lead early in the second quarter. Poli Banks returning a kickoff for a touchdown. In the Big Ten, Wisconsin, their best start since 1912 when they started and finished 7-0. Are they looking ahead to Michigan? If they were, it was a mistake because Minnesota was tough in the dome. Already up 7-0. Scott Eckers to Jack Rios with a 27-yard touchdown. Then back comes Wisconsin. They get the touchdown run right there from Brent Moss, the first one. And then another touchdown run of the Badgers coming back. It's 21-14 on two runs. Jim Wacker and his staff trying to get the Gophers going. Then Bevel throws. The ball is batted up in the air and intercepted. Minnesota's defense holds. They win back the Paul Bunyan axe as the Badgers suffer their first loss, 28-21. Brent Moss had the two touchdowns, but now the seven unbeaten, untied teams are left. USC and Notre Dame. The Irish come out fired up using the backup quarterback Paul Fela, but featuring the same strong ground game. Lee Beckett on the second play from a scrimmage, 70 yards for a touchdown. Very quickly, the Irish up, and they never look back. Lou Holtz staying mainly on the ground, but he did get Fela to throw a little screen pass right here to Ray Zellers. Breaks some tackles, gets a couple of blocks downfield, and goes 30 yards. Irish led it 28-7. They win it 31-13. They've beaten the Trojans 11 straight times, Lee.
Chris, Lee Becton led the Irish on the ground today. The Irish scored four times in the first half. They had the ball four times. That ain't bad.
Next opponent for the Irish.